up and welcome back to the Section 10 Podcast, episode 459, presented by Underdogs Fantasy. It is the home of your 7-3 second place Boston Red Sox. My name is Jared Carrabas, and I am a certified G and a bona fide stud, and you can't teach that. And this right here, this is Coley Mick, and he's 7 foot tall, and you can't teach that. And this right here, this is Tyler Milliken, and he killed his dog Bullet, and you can't teach that. Bada boom, realest guys in the room. Steve, how you do it?
What up, Section 10 in the building?
In the motherfucking building. Presented by Blue Moon.
Suck one.
You better be sucking one. You better be sucking one off after the night that I just had. Went to the Prudential building. What's it called? Views something? I don't know. It was the 52nd floor. I think it's what, like, not Windows on the World. That was the World Trade Center. What was top of the hub? Mm. Top of the hub. It used to be top of the hub. Now it's like a fucking observatory, whatever the fuck. It was weird. I was driving around Boston, and the number of people, it was like an apocalyptic movie. They were just like, everyone was outside. They're like looking up at the sky. It's like, it's a fucking eclipse, dude. Just Google it. Who cares? Yeah. Who cares? Like, Tyler, I feel like you're someone stupid that would care about the eclipse.
Why the fuck would I care about the eclipse? I had no idea. I just wanted to look at it one time, bare eye, to see what was going on.
So you did.
But I was asked not to.
So you're proving my point. You're proving my point. Like, you're the type of dude that'd be like, oh, it hurts your eyes if you don't use the glasses. I'm going to raw dog the fucking eclipse. And you did.
I was curious. It's a once in a lifetime thing. You think I'm making it to 2044? You think I'm going to live to 2044?
There was one in 2017. There'll probably be an eclipse in like 3 years. Who cares?
No, the next one's 44.
Yeah, well, you never know. The eclipse could come early.
Classic early eclipse.
Tyler?
Did you stop at Italy while you were there? That's one of my comfort places.
I don't give a shit.
I walk out. Hey, wait.
I don't give a fuck, Tyler. I'm in an awful mood tonight.
It'll make you happy.
I've had a long fucking day. Roman Reigns lost the fucking world heavyweight title last night. Steve, what are your thoughts?
My God, should I give them now? Because I have a lot of thoughts.
Yeah, Jimmy, like the cliff notes, obviously, we can do like a full breakdown at the end. Like, how are you feeling right now?
I feel sad for you because I know how much the Tribal Chief means to you. First off, I feel sad for you. Secondly, I'm just happy that Cody Rhodes finished the story, right? Like, I think that's something that you got to look at. I'm up big, baby.
Fuck his story, Steve. Fuck his story. All he does is cry. He cried. They took him out of the main event. He cried. They put him back in. He won. He cried. He opened up Monday Night Raw tonight. He fucking cried. I saw the people in the Section 10 Reddit crying because we talk about wrestling. Why are people crying so much? Why are people crying? The Red Sox are 7-3. To open the season, if I said, hey, T-Dog, what do you think? First 10 games of the season, what do you got the Red Sox at? 2-8, probably. They're 7-3. They're 7-3. They should be 9-1. They lost a game in extra innings at Kenley. His back hurt, and they had a 3-1 lead in extras. That's a win. And then we'll talk about it in this series against the Angels. Rafael Devers, if he can make a fucking routine play at third base, they win that game too. They sweep the series. They should be 9-1. No, what? What?
I'll add Pablo to that. I'll add Pablo to that.
Steve? All right. Steve?
I just wanted to say the Undertaker's entrance was incredible.
Yeah. Chills?
Chills. The fact that he didn't walk down the ramp either, that he came up from the stage. Oh.
Yeah.
Incredible. Loved every second of it.
T-Dog?
So when I go to Italy, right, I usually go around
Shut
and I grab a
fuck
piece
up! Fuck! Shut up!
How did he think that
Shut
wasn't going to be a suspension?
Italy.
That's suspension.
That's crazy.
I think he was trying to get suspended there.
He's trying, like, yeah, that's like a, hey, like, Coley.
The better Italy's in New York as well, Tyler. So you're talking about the Boston one. It's fucking insane. And I don't give New York credit anything over Boston, because Boston's typically better in all regards. They have a much better Italy. So you can't be bringing it up.
No, Tyler needed the suspension lead, or at least a tie. He was like, Steve's up 1-0. I can't have this. We got a tie.
I'm so mad. I had a long day today. I had a lot of shit to do. And then on top of it, Coley.
Don't you dare lash out at our sweet baby boy, Rafael Devers. I don't want to hear.
Did that error not cost them the game?
They scored one fucking run, Jared. One run.
They only needed one run if he didn't make that fucking error.
That's an insane standard to hold this team to.
That's Steve. Steve?
Jared, I thought you had a great TV appearance today, pal.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks. Hey, woo. Woo. Thank you. Woo. Yeah, I was on TV today, guys.
Wait.
Oh, yeah.
Proud of you.
Yeah, cable television. Coley, what do you got?
We need a much more sarcastic applause as well. Like, yeah. We have that one, but we need one where it's just like a single. Eh, no, this is a chant.
Yeah, that's a chant.
TV, 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 TV. I was on TV today. But Jesus Christ, like, opening day is tomorrow. A million things to do today. And I got my parents are like, you know, what's the plan for tomorrow? I'm like, let me just get through today. Red Sox won the series. Roman Reigns losing last night really has fucked my whole week, I feel like. I don't think I'm going to recover. I really don't. Like, I'm going to have to go into this weekend and, like, reset somehow. I don't know if it's, like, a massage or just, like, a hike into the woods where I don't come back for a while. But there, I'm serious. I don't, like, Roman Reigns losing last night, I think, has put my week into a tailspin that I don't think I'm going to be able to land the plane here. This is, if I haven't crashed already on Monday, then we're headed that way at some point this week.
Do you think if Stone Cold, because a lot of people, as Steve knows, Cold was speculated to come out in that Undertaker spot. Do you think that would have made it easier for you?
No, because I love the Undertaker too. Like, I was, I freaked out for the Undertaker. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, you should know this. When you walk into my house, I have the frame TV in the living room, and the picture on the frame TV is the Undertaker. Steve knows that.
Right.
Yeah. He did a great choke slam.
He did. It was a choke slam, Steve. Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
Great. Great is a strong word. Those were old men.
Yeah, well, for this time of his life, I really was impressed by that choke slam.
That's on The Rock for not jumping higher.
I don't know. I think The Rock did most of the lifting. And I think it was Boston Connor. Shout out Pat McAfee. Yeah. I think Boston Connor had a pick, like, perfectly of The Rock at the apex of that choke slam. And I was like, man, he might actually be the best actor of our generation, because he also looked like he shit his pants when he turned around. And he saw, and I know the Undertaker isn't really like the right arm of the devil, but I also don't not know that. You know what I mean? Like, he has some supernatural abilities. Yeah. We all agree.
By now, yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're the Undertaker and you walk around day and night just being the Undertaker, eventually, like, the devil's going to be like, I fuck with this guy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Tyler? You're going to say something that has nothing to do with WrestleMania. It's going to piss me off. Go ahead.
I had an inspiring quote that maybe would give you hope to keep moving forward. Let me read it. Let me read it before you hit it. Let me read it before you hit it. Let me just say it.
The reach.
I'm trying to do something good here.
You're so lucky I was on the wrong page.
Fuck yes.
I was on the wrong page because I had to go get the gong. What is it, Tyler?
Failure is a part of the process.
Get the fuck out of here. God. That is terrible. I don't want a motivational quote. I don't want to feel motivated. Yeah.
Get a motivational quote. Fucking fade out.
No. Not on a night like this. Not on a night like this. Roman Reigns isn't the champion anymore. The Red Sox should have swept that series. They should be 9-1. Opening day is tomorrow. Is anyone else going? I know Steve's going. Jake, you're going. Yeah.
Oh yeah, I'll be there.
Yeah, we're gonna make some. Hey, Steve, you want to make some content tomorrow?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's make some hashtag content.
Fucking yelling. I'm just gonna be yelling, pissed off.
What would change? So, what would change your attitude from now until then? Anything?
I think when I get to Fenway, I'm just, like, going to be happy because I'm back at Fenway. And I think it's supposed to be nice weather tomorrow.
It
Steve?
Is. It is. It actually
little
is.
Little teaser.
Okay, so what's coming? I can bring it back.
Yeah, well, I only, yeah. Did I say?
No, you said indefinitely.
I said indefinitely. Yeah.
That was a strong word. I didn't want to rush anything.
Yeah, I meant 1 week.
Okay, fine. Yeah, it's going to be nice weather-wise, and I think just being at Fenway is going to be great. It's going to bring.
I need better than nice. I think I need better than nice. I need numbers. I need degrees. I need like heat and index.
Well, just for a little teaser here, we're closing in on 60.
Ooh, a little sunshine? Or is it going to be overcast 60?
Sunshine for BP and start of the game, and then overcast a little bit as the game goes on. But the sun's short peeking through.
It's important. It's important to go like hourly there.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. That's good to know. I'm excited for tomorrow. T-Dog, you are working, yeah?
Yes, I'll be at the Hub.
The Sports Hub 98.5?
Yes.
Okay. Coley, you will be in. You'll be in Maine.
I'm hitting a padlock.
Oh, okay. So they've been hitting what? Meyer, Anthony, Teal, 1, 2, 3 in the order.
Anthony Meyer Teal, what? I believe.
Anthony Meyer Teal.
Yeah.
Saw the report today that the Red Sox are not just gonna pull up Marcell Meyer just because Trevor Story is. It's done crazy. For the year.
Rosenthal with the big scoop.
Yeah, I mean, like, I think that's, I hate to, again, I'm just like angry and I'm in a bad mood, but you got to kind of call out the casuals. That's a casual take.
It's a like, simpleton thing to say.
Like, Story's done for the year? You got to get Meyer up here, kid. You got to get Meyer. He's their top shortstop prospect, kid. You got to get, it's like, dude, he's in fucking double A. He was hurt last year.
Oh, but he plays short, right?
Yeah, he's a fucking top prospect shortstop. You got to get him up here. Save the fucking season. It's like, no, you don't. You actually don't have to do that. That's not to say that he wouldn't do a good job up here, but it's like you're not going to compromise his growth as a minor league baseball player just because Trevor Story went down. I mean, there's someone on this podcast that is very keen on David Hamilton. Perhaps the biggest David Hamilton guy that I've ever met personally. His name's Coley Mick. He's right there. All right, should we get into the series? Let's get into the series. Get into the series. And by the way, shout out to the Section 10 Reddit for making me feel better about the notes, because I didn't know. I was like, do people like it? Do people not like it? And they were like, yeah, like it's good to have a reminder of the things that happened that may have fallen through the cracks if you didn't make note of them otherwise. I will say this series, full pages. Like for the first two games, the middle game of this series, the entire page. That's the first time this season that I've taken enough notes that would take up the entire page. Everything else has been, 75 to 80% full, but these are 100% full for these Angels games. So without further ado, the series opener was, the first thing I got here, Tyler O'Neill is, and this is crazy how much this already like has been confirmed since like, it was like a thought in game one where it's confirmed at this point, Tyler O'Neill is going to be much better than I thought. I feel like when we talked about Tyler O'Neill after he was acquired by the Boston Red Sox, and it still remains, the narrative is, need this guy to stay healthy. Hope he stays healthy. If he stays healthy, then we know what he can do. But the last time he was healthy was what? 4 years ago, 3 years ago, whatever it was.
Three.
So Tyler O'Neill going to be much better than I thought. Just hope he stays healthy because one of the hope he stays healthy guys is probably going to be out for a long time, maybe the entire year.
Yeah.
No, he's been great. I got some stats on. Do you want some stats?
I love some Stevie stats.
All right. I had some stats just because it reminded me of Adam Duvall's start last year. They both have made 8 Sox starts. At least these stats are 8 starts in. OPS, O'Neill 1406, Duvall 1544. Home runs, O'Neill 5, Duvall 4. RBI, O'Neill 5. I love that, by the way. He's like, I'm only driving myself in. You guys figure out your RBIs. I'm only going to drive
Mike Trout style.
He's got 5 solo bombs, and those are all of his RBIs. Duvall had 14 by now, which is just crazy. Ridiculous. Extra base hits, O'Neill 5. And that's another thing. He's like, if I'm getting an extra base hit, it's going to be a home run. Duvall 10 by this point. And on-base percentage, exactly the same, 514 for both those guys.
I saw the dumbest argument of all time happening on Twitter the other day.
of this exact comparison. It was like someone saying like Tyler O'Neill was this year's Adam Duvall, and someone being like, he can't be this year's Adam Duvall. Adam Duvall hit a walk-off home run in that first series against the Orioles. Like, the Red Sox have not played a home game yet. I don't know if you've noticed that. That's a big part of the whole walk-off home run thing, is you must play a home game. Mm. The Red Sox, like, opening day was like 5 weeks ago, and we are now getting to opening day, which is tomorrow. I don't exactly want to spend a ton of time on the opening day drama. It just feels like very clickbaity, to use a word. I don't know how you disagree, Coley?
Like, you're talking about Derek Lowe stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm glad he said it. I think it would have been weird if no one addressed it. Curt Schilling was, you could argue, the most pivotal member of the 2004 team, and he's not here, and it's his fault.
100%. But I feel like we know that. Like he's an asshole.
Sure, but I think ignoring it entirely isn't the way to handle it either. I don't think they need to keep talking about it. Like, I don't think Manny has any profound thoughts on this.
Might.
You know,
or
knows that it happened. You know what I mean? Yeah. Who knows? Yeah. He thinks he's like here to try out, I think. I think he thinks he's getting a look.
Yeah.
He's like, I can play some short. I've definitely played short before. But yeah, I thought not that Derek Lowe spoke about it or that anyone spoke about it, but Derek Lowe basically being like someone would have swung on him if he showed up.
Yeah.
Was less than clickbaity. Like, it was insane to see Lowe just be like, no, we all really fucking hate that guy. I'm glad he's not here.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm glad that it was to that degree, I guess.
But like, only so many guys can speak on it. Like, he said himself, he's like, I spent time with Wake. Like, we were golfing together. We were doing these different things. Like, he made it very clear to anyone who was spending time with him that this needed to be private, that it shouldn't be out there. You know, that was the only thing that made me wonder with the Doug Mirabelli thing, because obviously he got caught, right? That's who Curt said he had got it from, the information. So is that why Doug isn't there as well? Is that kind of where? Because it felt like he would be almost the perfect person there, not to represent Wakefield, but, you know, the closest player in association.
It really sucks that Schilling is this. Like, it doesn't have to be like this. Like, when people ask, like, favorite Section 10 moments, it was the show at his house. We had him on again a couple of years later, and when he's talking ball, he's so good and has some stories that are just incredible. And then he does stuff like this where it's like, dude.
But he, like, he doesn't care, because, like, I remember trying to make a conscious effort knowing that he says dumb fucking shit. And I was like, hey, like, we'll use like a dump button, basically. Like, anytime you start talking about politics or you say some dumb shit, like, I'm gonna like cut you off. The guy tried to protect Curt from Curt, and I don't think he cares to be protected, and that was ultimately his downfall. And yeah, like, I don't know that he's ever gonna be able to like show face around here again.
No.
I've told the story before on the show, but I know we have a bunch of new and different listeners. When I was a security guard in 2013, this is before he had fucked up anything.
Well, for Rhode himself. Island.
No, that's what I'm gonna say. He hadn't gone on, like, he was still working at ESPN, so he hadn't, you know, been crazy racist publicly multiple times over. He hadn't threatened journalists directly, stuff like that. He hadn't outed like one of his good friend's cancers to the world. Like, he hadn't done any of that. He had only bankrupted Rhode Island at this point, which I don't know that if that was the only thing he did, if people would still care now. You know what I mean? No. I don't know if that would have followed him 15 years later.
Rhode Island's still mad about that.
Rhode Island's furious, understandably so. But in 2013, I mean, he was on the same panel as, I believe, A-Rod. And also, what was it? It was the old Reds, Barry Larkin. And people are walking by. This is 9 years after 2004. I've never heard shit talk to a person like they were talking to Curt. Red Sox fans were talking to Curt. Again, this is in the midst of a World Series run. And people hated him then. And he's only 11 years later made it worse.
Way worse.
Yeah.
Like, shout out Tim Thomas. the old Bruins goalie. I know, because he's said it a couple of times, he aligns with Schilling on certain things. That guy lives in a hole in the woods and doesn't talk to fucking anybody. If Curt Schilling had just done that, he would be like the biggest icon in this. Like, he would be one of the premier Boston icons.
He'd be in the Hall of Fame. He'd be also in the Baseball Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
How destructive he is to his own, you know, legacy and credibility.
And the thing with like, and Tim Thomas, anytime I heard Tim Thomas talk, I'm like, oh, he's kind of boring too. So he's got some tough takes and he's boring. Kurt's not that. So like, yes, we all hate Curt and I'm right there with you, but it's a waste of a great former Red Sox icon that now, to Jared's point, he can't come back to Fenway.
No,
you can't.
No. And that sucks because I feel like maybe T-Dog doesn't feel the same. Because you didn't like live 2004, but I feel like if you were a diehard Red Sox fan living through 2004, you feel like a certain, like, not like indebted to the guy, but like it's harder to be like, you know what, fuck you forever. But he made it that way so that the fans that feel that way are completely justified. It's not an overreaction to be like, get the fuck out of here type deal, but.
I sent the tweet when this all happened, late September, when he did it. It's near impossible to be, again, one of the faces of the team that broke an 86-year-old curse and universally detested by the entire fan base. Like, that's
put it this
so
way.
Hard to
like,
do.
The comparison, Coley, is like, if Curt never did any of this, and I don't know, like, if someone on the Cubs became detested, like the 2016 Cubs became detested by Chicago and how unfathomable that would be because of what that championship meant to Chicago. And then someone being like, that's like, you know, the city of Boston hating Curt Schilling. And it's like, well,
right.
Yeah. Like they got there.
So yeah, like immediately.
Yeah.
'Cause wait, he was on the 08 team, right? Or the 07.
No, he was on the 07 team. He was under contract for 08 and didn't pitch.
Okay.
But he signed a 1-year deal and didn't pitch.
That means within 5 years of playing for the team, he had ruined it all.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, he made his last Red Sox start in game 2 of the World Series, right? In 07. I mean, the guy, like, everything was.
That was his last career start. Yeah.
His whole career was like Red Sox career perfect. It was perfect. To what he could have done for the team. He did that and then some, and we all hate him.
Like 38 should be retired. You know what I mean? Like,
that should
like
be,
should have all
that should be a legitimate question. And right now, that's like, that would be the craziest thing ever.
That would be insane.
Imagine if they did that.
Yeah.
Genuinely insane.
We're putting it up there.
Yeah. Man. Yeah. It's a very good thing that he's not there because it would take away from the event. But yeah, get there early. They're doing a whole ceremony for Wake tomorrow. I'll be there. My family will be there. Steve will be there. Jake will be there. Yeah, it's weird to say you're looking forward to it, but like I am. Like I want to see what they do for Tim.
They'll do a great job.
They usually crush stuff like that.
Shout out Sarah McKenna
to the Red Sox. Yeah,
Sarah McKenna is she's the one. It's her, it's John Carter. I'm sure like Dr. Charles Steinberg is still in the mix for like, he's the one that made it look like Derek Jeter played his whole career with the Red Sox when Fenway did like the retirement ceremony for Jeets. And it was like one of the best Red Sox shortstops of all time.
Who could Derek forget? Jeter.
Yeah, like Derek Jeter got more of a send off by the Boston Red Sox than, I don't know, everyone except for Ortiz and Pedro maybe.
Pedro's moved me to tears.
Yeah, I mean,
so genuine tears.
I saw a TikTok the other day that showed what Yankee Stadium did for David Ortiz. It was the most polite, light clap with like a, I don't know, little over half full of a stadium. And then they panned to, then they immediately wiped to what the Red Sox did. And it was, I remember that vividly. I was working at Ness and then we were rolling all the tape back. I'm thinking, this is nuts. Like, what are they doing? We got the Aretha Franklin,
23 seasons with the Boston Red Sox. Derek Sanderson Jeter. We'll never forget him. They were about to retire his number. It was crazy. It was crazy. I feel like, you know, we don't make fun of the Red Sox enough for that retirement ceremony. But
and it was all weekend, right? It wasn't just the last game. I think it was all weekend they did.
It was every game. It was the whole season, even when the Red Sox were playing other teams. They were like, what was your favorite Derek Jeter moment?
I mean, they... to a much lesser degree, I honestly thought they were going to give Mo a ring in 05. Yeah,
that would have been ceremony. Cool, though.
That would have been funny. That would have been funny.
That would have been cool. He should have gotten one.
He got a standing ovation.
But, like, think out. Of how epic that would be if, like, you know, Tito, just,
you, pal.
Tito just jogs over to the Yankees, like, starting lineup there, just lining up at, or along the third baseline, and he gives a World Series ring to Mariano Rivera. It's like, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Reese back to spanking it, not giving a fuck. He is. I think there's like a later note on Reese spanking it where I said he's QB1. Whereas I feel like in the past, where you've had obviously two catchers, as every team does, it's a very Alex Cora thing to split them 50-50. Like, he's done that a lot with his catchers, split their playing time 50-50. I feel like Reese has made it a point to not do the 50-50 split. T-Dog?
Which is even weirder, because last year, Connor Wong kind of took up, I'd call it, 2/3. Like, he had gotten the better share because he was so good at receiving. That was kind of his thing, and then he'd run into a home run. But credit to Reese. He said he showed up to spring training earlier than he ever had in January, and he's changed his whole hitting approach. The guy who used to go oppo all the time is now pulling the ball almost 50% of the time. Like, that's a completely different shift than the player Reese McGuire was before. He's already done more in a week than he did last year. He was worth half a win in terms of WAR last year. He's at 0.4 right now. Mm. He had 16 RBIs last year. He leads the Red Sox right now with 8.
There you go. I'm more than fine with 2/3 with Reese.
So there's nothing Reese can do to not have the jerk off stuff come up, right? Like, it, Reese has a big day, and it's like every type of phrase for jerking off comes up.
So I had gotten away from the jerking off stuff, and then I had gotten away from that.
Not me, brother. Back better than ever.
I had gotten away from the jerking off with Reese, and then this year, it's like he's doing so well that, like, why does it have to be a negative? Why can't jerking off be a positive? And to me, I'm sure it's something that he doesn't want to be affiliated with. But listen, you don't get to pick your nickname. You don't get to pick what the fans chant in the stands. If you're the jerk off guy, you're the jerk off guy. You got to own that. We all do it, brother. Come on now.
At home.
Yeah.
We all do it at home. That's the
key distinction there.
Some people live in their cars.
Yeah. Some people do, no doubt.
Mm-hmm, 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 mm-hmm.
I will say, it seems like Reese's teammates like him. Brayan Bello and Reese McGuire are like one of the greatest duos I think I've ever seen.
Who's if sitting the Red here Sox saying he's not likable? He's talking about spanking.
Yeah. But in general, usually when a guy has something like that attached, you're like, all right, is he a fucking weirdo? Is he, you know, do the teammates look at him kind of funny? Seems like the team has always liked him. He's boys with everyone. Bale loves him to death.
Mm-hmm.
I think we can love
that. That was in the finale. It just hit me. Or when did he had the big game in the finale, right?
First and third game.
Oh, first and third. Yeah. He had
that's
a big
why,
series.
That's why he's in the notes, Steve.
Exactly. No, but it hit me like there's nothing he can do to get away from the jerk off allegations. Not even the allegations.
No.
Obviously, it happened.
No,
but
you can't live that down. Like, imagine if Tyler got arrested for jerking it in a fucking Dollar Tree parking lot.
He's done.
You think we're gonna spend one episode on that?
It'd definitely be at a Papagino's or something like that.
Papagino's. Yeah,
I have class.
Yeah, I mean, it's not that we don't like him. I mean, he's fine. Yeah, I don't know him at all, so. It's just, it's going to follow him. It is what it is. I don't, my hands are tied here.
You've left me no choice.
Yeah.
I got to bring it up.
What do you mean?
You can't be the jerk off in public guy. Like, we have such strict rules about that. Like, that's really like the border of like society collapsing. If we start like, So it's like, it's not a thing where I'm like, oh, get this pervert off the team. Like, that's not it at all. It's just like, hey, it's a jerk off guy. It's funny.
And I'm not even saying it in negative. It's more just when I see it on Twitter so much, I'm like, you're right to put it out there. Like, it's correct to tweet this, even though I'm a little tired of it.
It doesn't need to be beaten into the ground.
All right.
Oh, I didn't fucking mean it like that.
Yeah, you did.
No, I didn't. I swear to God, Jake, you know I didn't mean it like that.
Yeah, clearly didn't mean it like that.
I swear to God, I didn't mean it like that.
I didn't think you meant it like that either, but it was a folks.
Yeah, it was a folks, but I wouldn't have noticed it if you didn't say folks.
That's what I'm here for, to say folks.
Next note, Trevor Story has made a handful of plays that were not outs last year. Following note, Trevor Story's season may be done before the home run.
The whole team, man. They looked like mentally they just lost the ability to play defense, and it went through the rest of the weekend.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's Gordon Hayward. This is who he is. He's Gordon Hayward. Rafael Devers reacted the exact same way Jaylen Brown did when Gordon Hayward's leg exploded. It was the same thing. And I shout out Mike Trout. You want to know why that guy's never done anything with his life? The ball was laying there for 20 minutes. He could have scored on that play. I genuinely believe if he had kept running, he scores there. And he just stayed at first. What an asshole.
Yeah, there's plenty of players in the league. Like, who's the first player that comes to mind? I don't have one off the bat. Who's the first player that comes to mind that would have scored on that play? Just like
Ellie.
The shortstop dives, writhing in pain, and he's just booking it.
Duran was like, the guy I thought of, honestly. I think Jaren's going. He doesn't care that you're hurt.
Either of the Cruises, Ellie or O'Neal.
True.
But I don't think it's out of like malice. Evil. I think they're just so fast. They don't even
I'm not
realize.
Saying he doesn't
like,
care.
All the ball's live.
I'm saying he knows the ball's in play. Like, I'm gonna keep going if this is a live ball.
Yeah. I feel like Duran finds a way to get out on that play. He's like, can I go? Can I go? And then he gets like picked. Like, eventually someone's just like, yeah, dude, you're out. Like, you're out.
Yeah. He'd be out at first on that play somehow.
Yeah. He's trying to get it. He's like, is it a foul? Is it a foul ball?
Throw it over. I'm out? Guy's dead at short. What the hell?
That was insane. I mean, genuinely. It was earlier that game he made, I thought, his best play of the season.
Oh,
like,
so
genuinely
good.
Best throw, best glove on it, best range. Like, that was deep up the middle. And he had been playing, as I've said all year, deep third. So him to make that play was absurd. And then, as Jared's notes say, 2 seconds later, he dives for a ball that was already a single. I don't know that Trout was going to try and stretch it for two, considering he still didn't, even with the ball laying there and Devers having no interest in picking it up.
None.
That's where it was just like, I don't know that he needed to do that. Obviously, showing off the glove. I'm not going to knock the guy for it. He was trying to make a play, trying to keep a guy at first. But, man, shit luck doesn't even begin to describe it.
No. Side note here, completely unrelated. Big piece. Did you know that he's in the big leagues right now?
Injuries?
No, big piece. 2 innings, 1 hit, no walks, 3 strikeouts against the Yankees tonight.
Thank you, big piece.
Shout out to Piece.
I mean, they lost 7-0, but
smoked.
Whitlock was forever.
Yeah, losing Trevor Story is that's not what you want. If you're the Boston Red Sox, because if immediately like we are looking at the impact that Trevor Story can have defensively at shortstop, and how, like, if you watch the Boston Red Sox last season, you should know more than anyone how important defense at shortstop is, where we had to watch Kike Hernandez just chuck balls all over the place and just dive for balls that he didn't get to. And it was brutal. Having a great defender, not a good, a great defender at shortstop like Trevor Story was such a luxury to enjoy for 9.5 games.
Just looking at Pablo, it's even plays that aren't, you know, an error or whatever it may be, but just the plays where maybe he gets a little bit of a glove on it. That's where you tell the difference. Like Cora says all the time, like, you give a team extra outs. Trevor Story made sure regularly you never gave those teams extra outs. That was the major thing to me, and it felt like every other game this series, including that night, you ended up having to work harder than a pitcher would need to. And for this pitching staff, that's asking so much. They went into that game, that first game on Friday night, They were top seven in every defensive metric. Outs above average, defensive run saves, whatever you want to call it. They're still pretty good in outs above average. After this weekend, they're right in the middle in terms of defensive run save. And no David Hamilton, you know, slander or anything like that. I'm not trying to upset your goalie.
Brother.
But last year, it was a rough showing for him defensively. And I know the Red Sox gave him that participation trophy of defensive player of the year in the minor leagues. There's not many people that think he can play. You know, Sox prospects, they'll say it all the time. The guy is not a big league shortstop. If you have him there, you're asking for too much. I don't like watching Pablo Reyes there regularly as well, because you're talking about whether it was the transfer play in the second game, the ball that went off his glove before that. It's just you needed that defense with Rafael Devers on the left side and Emmanuel Valdez on the right side. He was able to kind of make up that difference between them without a plus shortstop there. I don't know. I think you start to fall into a range where you're putting more pressure on the pitching staff. It just kind of brings the overall ceiling of the team down.
I know the right.
And that's before the right-handed conversation in the lineup.
The right mentality to have is like, how do the Red Sox replace him? Are they going to get somebody? Is it Rafaela? I've just felt so bad for Story since this happened, because they keep panning to him in the dugout. It's like, damn, man. It's again, he's going to be out. And again, it's going to be him just, you know, cheering guys on with a brace on or whatever. I did the math. If he's out for the rest of the season, he'll have missed 305 games that he was supposed to play in. And that's saying that he'd have like 150 games played per year, which is he was doing that in Colorado. So it just sucks. Like I know the right mentality is to be like, who's next? And, you know, let's keep this rolling. Sox are 7-3. But I just feel genuinely terrible for him.
Yeah, I don't know anyone like thrilled about this, but it even came out when David Hamilton got called up. He was playing with like a broken wrist last year. So that's where it's like, I know Sox prospects have followed him his whole, since we acquired him from the Brewers. I'm not saying they don't know better, but that's not a small thing. I don't know that he can't play an average defense. I agree with people. Von Grissom, keep him at second. We know he's a below average shortstop at this level. I think he's athletic enough to be average, but I'd rather just put him at second where we've had a hole for fucking ever. He's our second baseman. The conversation with Rafael, I struggle with tremendously. I think he's good enough for it, but I think moving him to short makes the entire team defense worse in a way, because now you're playing a much worse outfield, which I know it's a small, small sample size. We can point directly to two wins being saved by Rafael's glove in center field. I don't know that we can do that with Story's glove at short. If anything, out of all the games that have been close, his glove almost cost them one.
Well, we can say already there's one game, that middle game, that, you know, part of it, if Pablo Reyes gets that ball at second, you never even get to the point of Devers fumbling that ball, right? On the transfer. I think where you have that conversation with Zidane Rafaela, right? If you move him to shortstop, it kind of fixes the logjam in the outfield. And the outfield is better than it was a year ago. Masataka Yoshida isn't going to be out there every day. You'd be giving Willy Abreu regular at-bats, which, yes, he hasn't looked great so far this season and through spring training, but that's a guy they believed
awful.
In.
Terrible.
He hasn't looked great,
like,
right?
Saying but he hasn't looked great is not telling the whole story. He's looked fucking awful.
It's been a rough run, but it's been inconsistent. So, you know, every day at bats, I'd still like to see him, because I believe in Willy Abreu. I believe in what we saw in September. If we sucked him off like we did all offseason, I'm not going to throw it out after a week. I'm just not.
I'm not either, but I'm just saying he hasn't done a fucking thing.
Of course, but if you're... And I think you add in the bat there, right? And you hope Willy Abreu can be a league average bat. When Rob Refsnyder comes back, that's his platoon partner. Because we all agree, Tyler O'Neill doesn't have a choice. He has to play every day now. Like, this is what it is, whether you want to protect him or not. You have no right-handed bats in your lineup that offer any punch. He is the only guy.
I do wonder also now with the extension too, when we've already seen what he can do in center field, he can win a gold glove out there. Do you want to mess with that and now put him at shortstop? And I know he can play shortstop. And I get what you're saying, Tyler. Like, it does open up the outfield, but
we don't have
a
choice.
Like, yeah,
it's not messing him up. I don't like that line.
It's not messing him up. What if he's way better at shortstop? That's a much bigger problem.
That is a problem.
You have to cut Trevor Story. Listen, that's not a joke. No one in the league would, in their right mind, would trade for Trevor Story. Nobody. I don't say that to be mean. I say that because it's a fact. No one's trading for that contract. Chris Hill played last year.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's what you hope. You could get a couple
and
months.
And even that, you
get
have
a
to pay
months of Story.
With 70%
of that
contract?
If he's out the rest of the year, he's got no suitors. No chance.
None. Not, and that's not enough. It is what it is. It's a lot of money. He's got, what, 4 years left after this? He hasn't been healthy. Steve just said he's missed 350 games. That's insane. Or 300. What was it?
305, but it might as well be 350.
305, you said, at 150 average pace. That's what it was. Like, combine the numbers.
All good.
If Rafaela, fuck Gold Glove. If he goes and wins Platinum Glove at shortstop, Trevor Story's off the team. Like, that's, he's your DH who can't hit. Like, I don't know what
they're
going to
put. They put him in center. Like, that's what they were in, like,
Texas, right?
Yeah, like the Rangers.
And the Padres,
like, Yeah, they're like, we'll put you in the outfield, I guess. But
I don't know you can risk that. I don't know that you can risk that.
I like Rafaela, and I think he could play above average shortstop, and I think he's a better option. You know, when you look at the infield and what it is, where you have at least two well below average defenders, Devers and Valdez, but you put Rafaela there, he's good there. I think he's above average. Center field, he is generational. It is true top of the top. And if he plays a great shortstop, awesome. Trevor Story is one of the best defensive shortstops in baseball. We've seen that. That's no joke. You look at the metrics last year, he was. If you looked at outs above average, he would have been the best and highest mark last year over that.
He played a month.
Over a month. And he wasn't completely right. He wasn't completely right.
I understand
that. We still saw it this year where he was already one out above average.
I'm not saying he's a bad defensive player by any means, but I think if you go down the list, he's not top five defensively.
Defensively, I think he could go head to head with anybody.
No,
I do.
That's wrong.
That wise, who's obviously better than him?
Lindor.
Him and Dansby Swanson are basically the same profile. It's a weak arm at shortstop. Huh?
I think Dansby's better. And I genuinely believe that. I was wanting to sign him last year to keep Story at second, which, by the way, looks smarter by the second.
Yeah, if you're going to dive and your shoulder's going to explode, your shoulder's going to explode. But at the end of the day, we saw Trevor Story be as elite defensively as somebody could be for a 45 game stretch.
He missed a ball
so bad. What was going to change?
He missed a ball so bad in the Oakland series, they couldn't even give him an error for it. That's not an elite glove. He's a great glove. The ball skipped by Devers. We're blaming him for a game we scored one fucking run.
Devers has been one of the worst defensive third basemen for years. Trevor Story came back last year and was elite.
Again, elite I'm having trouble with. He's above average for sure. Way above average. Elite is not true.
If you pinned it over 162, he would have been the best defensive shortstop.
He cannot play 162 games. We know that.
So you're
3 years
better
than
that. Like,
he's not here for 3 years.
Hold on.
His elbow exploded in his hand shot.
We're saying similar things here.
He swung at a pitch that was going to hit him in the ribs.
Let me step in here for a second. Like, what Tyler's saying is that for when he's on the field, he's an elite defensive shortstop. You're saying he can't be an elite defensive shortstop because he doesn't play a full season.
But I don't think he's a top five defensive shortstop in baseball.
That's crazy.
Who's
what
above
do you
him?
Mean?
That's Who's crazy. That's
Nick
crazy.
Ahmed
to say.
Has two gold gloves playing in the same National League Trevor Story played in.
Yeah,
Who
but you get a
gold
glove for playing the full season. Yeah. Like if Trevor Story played a full season,
but he was playing.
Season,
we just established he was playing 150 games in Colorado. That's not new. That's why I use the NL comparison. In the NL, Nick Ahmed was eating off his plate.
So why
it's like when people used to say
best.
Lindor had a better bat than Xander. Xander kept winning Silver Sluggers right in front of him. Like that, I don't know what people want. Like, he's not one. And I've said it all offseason. It's insane he's never won one because everyone always talks about his glove. I think he's a great fielder. I don't think he's elite. I think that's misconstrued. I think he gets more credit than he deserves there.
It's semantics at this point. He's
Nick
whether
Ahmed's
he's
the
good
best
or great, he doesn't suck, and
okay.
the team is worse because he's not out there. Is the point?
And the other point's how good would Rafaela be at short? That's a genuine question because I don't know. We don't know. We have no idea. No. What you're saying, Tyler, with generational talent in center, I take back the mess him up. I don't really mean mess him up, but I just wonder from the team's perspective. With the ceiling he has in center field being such an important position, would they want to change that?
I guess where I would question was you were willing to do it in September last year. You had him getting some reps at shortstop at the end of spring training as well. Second base too with the Vaughn Grissom thing as that came in. It just should be a consideration. But I think if you look at what Breslow's saying and the roster moves made today, it looks like they're not going in that direction, or at least not on a regular basis. It looks like they prefer to give it to Romy Gonzalez and platoon it that way and kind of see what happens. But I don't know. I think the loss of Trevor Story defensively is a major, major blow to this team.
I'm with Tyler on that one.
Well, it's also, if you just invested 8 years in Rafaela, what did you invest in him for? Do you think this got expedited because of the story.
That's
injury.
A good point. I do wonder if it got sped up because of story. There's a chance. I mean, you got to think the talks have been happening for a while.
Sure. Yeah, I don't think they started 2 days ago.
It started right when he got here. All right, we're going to have to give 8 years.
What does him being hurt for 1 year matter for the next seven?
Expedited them locking him in. Yeah, I mean, I guess he's here either way, right?
But, yeah, he's under team control for the next fucking 5 years. Like, it's not like he's approaching free agency.
And with Rafaela, like, this is part of his skill set. Like, there's so few players that could go from center field to shortstop and actually play the position. This isn't Christian Arroyo in right field.
Well, this isn't high school. Like, in high school, every fucking center fielder can play shortstop and every shortstop can play center field. But in the big league, and they're their team's number one pitcher, too. But in the big leagues, not everyone can fucking just be Mookie Betts and go from a corner outfield spot and be an elite defender out there and then go play fucking shortstop and lead the league in defensive run saved. It just doesn't work like that. Special player, special talent. It's the type of player that you want to like commit long term. Yep.
In terms of speeding it up, I think it would be the confidence they have. Like, here, we're going to give you this deal. And maybe the story thing might have had something to do with it in terms of like, we are very confident you can be a very good center fielder and shortstop if we need it.
Right. I think it's more
there's something
like,
to be said about that, where it's like, we're investing in you right now and you've only played like 40 games.
Yeah, that was crazy. We were talking about it before the show. I didn't I had to reread Cotillo's tweet several times because I was like, what do you mean?
Well, that's how you do it. Everyone wants to be the Braves, but no one has the balls that the Braves have. The Braves will go out there and identify a player. I mean, it's obviously not hard to identify, hey, Ronald Acuña Jr. is pretty good, huh? like obviously they've had more talented players to go out there, identify, and then sign to these long-term deals. But that's how you do it. And I feel like a lot of teams wait too long, and that's what costs you the chance to sign players to extensions like the one that the Red Sox just signed Sadan Rafaela to.
I think the easiest way to frame it is it's going to be a $6.5 million luxury tax hit over the next 8 years. Kevin Kiermaier got 1 year, 10.5 this year. Well, okay. We know Rafaela is going to be gold glove capable in center field no matter what. That's just hoping he gets to a league average bat and we're talking $4 million less. You know, in terms of your annual luxury tax hit, and that's going to be in 2030. What the hell is $6.5 million going to be in 2030? And you bought out 2 extra years of free agency.
Yeah.
It'd be worthless. The minimum at that point will be probably 1.5 to 2 million.
Jackie made $55 million for his career. I thought that was an interesting. If his bat is as inconsistent as Jackie's, but his gloves also as good, I would gladly give him $50 million over the next 8 years.
Yeah, I remember when Jackie was, I mean, he must have been 3 or 4 years out from free agency, and Boris was like, the benchmark is the Matt Kemp deal. It was like $140, $160 million, something like that. And we were like, what the fuck? A decade later, if this is what it takes to sign Rafaela, who profiles similarly with the questionable bat, we don't know what it is. It's got some pop. Don't know if he's going to hit for average, whatever, get on like the clip that he's going to get on base, but he's going to play elite defense. Then, yeah, sign me up for that. The meltdown for Cutter at the end, I don't want to say it ruined the outing for me, but it definitely didn't make me feel super great. It's not so much Cutter's fault as it is the rest of the rotation setting the bar so high. So Cutter Crawford, 4 2/3, 90 pitches, 2 hits, 1 earned, 3 walks, which we don't like, and the 5 strikeouts. And he really, really, really struggled, including fucking walking Anthony Rendon, which I said, I don't know what the punishment is for walking Anthony Rendon, but it has to be barbaric.
Disgusting.
And that loaded the bases with 2 outs in the 5th inning. The outing for Cutter, like when you look at it, 4 2/3, well, you didn't complete 5. Would like to see you go 6. The 2 hits, all right, no damage, only 1 earned run. All right, fine. The 3 walks, we don't love that. The 5 strikeouts, I can live with that. Call it a mixed bag, but it definitely didn't fit in. Like this start and the Bayo start in Oakland are the 2 worst of the season so far.
Feels very un-Cutter-like to do that, too. Like, is there any worse feeling watching at home than when a guy just doesn't have, like, he literally could not find the strike zone?
He just lost it.
Yeah. Like, has Cutter ever had that? I don't remember that happening.
Isn't this his flaw? Like, isn't this what we talk about with Cutter Crawford? He got up to 90 pitches and the wheels came off. Like the whole thing with Cutter adding weight this offseason and building up was supposed to be, hey, you only went, what, six innings, I think, five times last year or whatever it was. You need to be that guy now. You can't be completely emptying the tank and falling apart in the fifth inning. I'll agree that this was like dramatic. It was crazy. He just could not throw a strike anymore. But this is what Alex Cora was kind of telling him he needed to grow up and kind of become. He was not able to do that. His first real test where he had to get close to 100 pitches, he wasn't able to sustain. Now, I like Cutter, and there's a reason I picked him as one of my breakout guys this year. But this felt like at least a step in the wrong direction on that front for me.
Cora was pretty pissed. Cora was pissed,
yeah, because he needs five. Yeah. He needs five out of you. This isn't what it was a year ago. You're not building up. You're not getting stretched out there anymore.
Cora gave a little extra like oomph in the post game of like, yeah, it's, I think he said unacceptable or something about what Cutter did. So he kind of went out of his way to be like, going to need a lot better than that. But I don't know. I was just surprised. I trust Cutter out there. So I was surprised. I'm like, God, he can't throw a strike. This is crazy.
He, like it says here in the notes that Tyler so lovely types up. And I mean that sincerely, but it says he was sharp until Story went down. I don't necessarily agree. He was missing up kind of all day. And I know you talked about it on the broadcast too. He's like, he's not hitting his spots necessarily. And I think when he's been on, yeah, the wheels haven't necessarily fallen off, but that's where I think we're very high on what Andrew Bailey's done to us. I know Jared was preaching the good word today to the national audience. Mm-hmm. It's still early. And I think this is one of those reminders, like these are not finished products. Like the returns early have been awesome.
And these are not good lineups that they're facing.
No, of course not. But last year they weren't winning these games at all. And they were getting shelled too. Like, we'll get to it, but Hauk doing what he did in that Angels game, I'm not going to call it a must win. It's still April, you understand, but that was for him personally, string together two starts like that. That impressed me. I don't care if one of them was Oakland, him doing it again to someone else on the road, second longest road stretch to ever open the season in Red Sox history. Like that was a big start in my eyes. And Cutter, I don't know. Talk to me in a month. If he's still doing shit like this, I'll be more concerned. We're still early in the Andrew Bailey era. I'm giving it some time.
That's fair.
He was pitching a little differently than he did in that first start where we were talking about him using the sweeper and going all that. He was four-seamer heavy in the start because, Coley, kind of like you said, he was not hitting with the sweeper. He couldn't locate it like he was the last time. But that first hit that Story dove on, that was the first hit he gave up that game.
Right.
Like out of it all. So while the command wasn't sharp, you know, he was getting through and he wasn't, you know, working super deep into counts either. It wasn't the Garrett Whitlock situation we saw the next night. But this is his biggest weakness. He hasn't checked that box off yet.
One thing I want to add, Jerry, I don't know if this is in the notes for game one, the latest start ever, a half hour delay.
That's
for
crazy.
Your opening day is insane. Absurd. Obviously, I'll give you, you know, 20 seconds for the flyover. Good flyover. But that was nuts. Cole, you were tweeting about it. How many commercial breaks? And we'll be right back after the first pitch is going to be after the. Oh, I promise you, after this, we're going to have the first pitch. Like, what the hell?
Like,
what day was that? Friday?
Game one, Friday.
Yes, yeah, Friday. Our brains from all of the sports we've watched are conditioned, like Pavlov's dog, to know when things are happening. Like, you know, in basketball, for instance, they do the fake comeback where they show, like, three highlights and talk over it and throw it to one more commercial, and then they actually come back. Like, you're conditioned to know that. You're conditioned to watch Bones for 7 minutes before the TNT game starts. You're conditioned for when Tom Caron says, we'll be right back, after that, the game's going to fucking start. You're going to see Jaron Duran holding the back, getting some swings in. You're going to learn a little blurb about Griffin Canning or whatever the fuck his name is. And then the baseball is going to happen. TC, and I know it's not TC's fault. TC did that maybe 12 times. Like, he was just pump fake, pump fake, pump fake. And I think he kept being told, like, yeah, now we're going to start. And then mid-segment, it was just like, the Angels have not introduced fucking Ron Darling yet. He's never played for this franchise, but they're introducing him today. Like, that, it's insane how long that took.
Also, if you're going to be throwing out a 9:38 first pitch, was maybe the dumbest thing to market ever. We're going to start at 9:38 and then it's 10:10. Like, what are we doing, T-Dog?
Also, what an unreal move to be showing Shohei Ohtani highlights. like on the board after you let him walk over the offseason, the greatest player we've ever seen in our lifetime. You're like, hey guys, you want to see the worst fucking thing possible?
We just used
like
to showing have this Mookie. Guy. Check this shit out.
Listen, like,
what are we doing here?
I disagree. They should. There should be a, like the Jumbotron should constantly be showing Shohei.
Ohtani, Segoy.
They should only be showing Ohtani highlights. They're like, listen, this guy played here. We're damn proud of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Does he get a statue? Does Ohtani get an angel statue?
I would. While he's still active with the Dodgers, I would do it.
Mm-hmm. They would do that. Yeah. So Don Rafael getting too fucking cute out there. That was when it was an easy catch and he tried to say it was on the transfer. It wasn't. No, and then the next one was not convinced Valdez has played baseball before.
Good take.
Was this the barrel roll? Was this when he did like the
360? It's funny, I don't even know which one this is. This could be like 10 things. What was this one?
I think it was when he dove to his left and then just like made an awful throw or something like that. And then this, obviously, both of these events led to the most predictable grand slam ever. This was in the sixth inning. Can't even blame my guy, Josh Winkowski, on that one. It was there was nothing you could do. The baseball gods, that they ran the grand slam play from the start. You could just see it brewing. You knew it was coming. And almost down to the pitch, you knew when that shit was coming. So that made it a tie game. Yes. And then that leads to Duran can dye his hair whatever color he wants. That was the go-ahead home run to make it 7-6 in the eighth. They later tacked on a insurance run. But yeah, I was originally very concerned about Jaron Duran dyeing his hair back brunette when he had started off so hot with the blonde mullet. And I'm like, in other sports, whatever the fuck you want to do. If you're running back and you started the season blonde and then you want to go back to your original hair color, like knock yourself out. In baseball, you don't do shit like that.
No.
You start the season hitting 400 with an OPS over 1,000 and you have a blonde mullet. Well, guess what? You have a blonde mullet until you go on like a 0-19 streak. That's when you change it. You don't change it in the middle. That's baseball, baby.
He does look a lot better like this, though. I think we can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Red Sox win 8-6. The middle game. First line. I miss Trevor Story already. I have Pablo Reyes E6 ? This was in the second inning. I don't believe they gave him an error, but that was an error. That was an error.
Easily.
Yeah. I had an E6 on that. And the official scorer was like, nope, base hit. No, official score, E6. E6 on Pablo Reyes in the second inning. Jaron Duran stays hot. RBI knocks. This was in the third. Make it 1-0 Sox. Promptly picked off. Caught stealing. Shit for brains.
I can't. Not on this series. I got to give Duran some credit. Between that catch he made later in the game.
He's in this series, he is the reigning, defending, undisputed Clark's Ketchup Series MVP. But he'd be doing some stuff out there, you know?
He's been great. You can only imagine how good he would be if he had one single brain in his head. Just one.
I mean, the great thing about Jaron Duran, I said this on MLB Network this morning, is he's starting to learn his game better where he's like, wait a second, like I'm really fast. Like I said something to the effect of when you're Jaron Duran, you can look in the mirror and be like, I'm built like a superhero. So I should be hitting home runs. My game should be hitting home runs. But then you realize like I'm also really fucking fast. So I don't have to swing for the fences every time. I just have to get base hits because if I hit the ball in the air and it finds grass, then either I'm going to leg out a double because I'm that fast that I can do that, or it's going to be a base hit and I can just steal second base. And there you go. There's your double. So I think he's becoming smarter and more self-aware about what his total package is as a baseball player, which is great. Like, I think we're seeing it in real time this year. But then he does some shit like getting picked off and, you know, being 90% of the way down the line at third base and not scoring a run. So it is what it is.
Just kind of comes with the package, right? It's one of those things we're just kind of used to by now. It's like, meh.
Yeah. Yeah, you take the good with the bad with Duran. Like, you're going to get the good far more than you're going to get the bad. Yeah, you take the good with the bad.
what bothered me with Duran before was when he was scared to take those chances on the base paths. If you're going to get picked off once in a while, whatever, because you're going to go steal 6-for-6 before that. Mm-hmm. Like, you can take one of those blows. And the other thing I'll say, him going deep in the first game, while I love that he's shooting the ball the other way, Jaron Duran can hit 15 homers. That's in his arsenal. So if he can do that, give me the 15 homers, give me 30 bags, and you're getting a profile together that's a really, really solid baseball player. Someone that, you know, even if you play left field, then now he's probably going to get moved into center, and that's asking a lot. But he looks great in left field based off that catch he made. Like, that's a really solid player to have under team control.
Are you the one who had his defensive stats earlier, or was that stats?
I think it was stats.
Must have been stats. He was like 99th percentile in everything as a left fielder. That's, again, where I'm not really trying to fuck with the outfield. I don't, like, if Willie Abreu doesn't play, I'm sorry. Like, learn how to play shortstop, bud. Like, that's the hole we have right now. The outfield is perfect at the moment. And again, I get, if we're going to have ground, maybe it's pitcher-based where Rafael plays. You know what I mean? If we have a guy who profiles more as a ground ball pitcher, Rafael, you're playing shortstop today. It's more of a fly ball guy or lineup dependent. Now you're playing center. But more often than not, I need him in center.
I like that creativity, but I will say last year, Jaron Duran was 99th percentile outfield jump. That's the Kyle Hudson effect. And where it complicates thing is when we talk about last year's defense, while Duran wasn't winning a gold glove in center field, that's not what derailed the team. What derailed the team was what was happening at shortstop. And that's why Trevor Story rushed back and came back before, you know, he could hit a fucking baseball, clearly. And you had, you know, whether Yu Chang got you by for some time, but it was David Hamilton attempting to play shortstop with the torn UCL in his thumb. It was that. It was Pablo Reyes. You needed something better. And it's those plays. It's not even the errors that stick out. It's those ones that aren't errors where you're like, you know what? Story would have made that play. He would have picked you up. He would have got Garrett Whitlock that extra out there that he didn't have to work through. And that's the difference when you have these fringy borderline starters. One out or two outs, that's the difference in these games between you getting 25 outs or 25 innings through a rotation turn and not.
Tristan Casas can move for a thick boy. He made a diving catch in the third. nobody is able to look so good and so bad like Valdez. He made a diving play with two outs, runners at first and second in the fourth inning. Garrett Whitlock was meh. 4 1/3. 101 pitches, 4 hits, 0 earned runs. He walked 4 and struck out 4. So back-to-back kind of mess starts for the Red Sox in this series.
I do have a thought on the Whitlock start.
Go ahead.
My problem with the entire way he approached it was he went away from what worked at the end of the Seattle start. When he started pounding the zone with the sinker, that got him through after 3 inefficient innings, where it was heavy sweeper, you know, leading with the changeup, whatever it might be. He never went that way this time. He never started pounding the zone in order to keep his pitch count down. I just don't get why. That is one of his strengths. Why go away from it? Like, when Whitlock starts getting those 8-pitch inning, 12-pitch inning, that was what allowed him to go deep in Seattle. Why not bring that back out the second time through the lineup and give him a different look? Because they're fouling off so many pitches. Stats had it on his page talking about how Whitlock needs to generate more whiffs, and I do think it's an actual concern moving forward. Because that was his problem last year. So if you're not going to be able to get a ton of swing and miss, friggin' start pounding the zone and generating some weak grounders. But I don't know if that was them saying, well, we don't really believe in our infield defense right now. It's one thing when you have Trevor Story at shortstop and he can make these plays and kind of anchor. Right now we have Pablo Reyes, who already botched a ball, Emmanuel Valdez, and Devers. Good luck.
Is that it? Or is this another guy who's also never pitched a full season and they're trying to figure out how to get him from start to start?
Maybe it could be both, but what I'm saying is it worked the previous start and paid off in a big way. Yeah. I don't know why you would go away from it this start.
The problem with Whitlock isn't he can make one start. We know if there's someone who can make one start, it's Garrett Whitlock. Can he make 25 is the question. And if he can't pound the zone, like, we know as a reliever, yeah, he can empty the tank. He can pound the zone for 2 innings. Can you do it for 6 twice in a week? That's the question. That's the thing. Same thing with Houck. Like, it's hard to get crazy excited about 2 starts with any of, especially them too, when we know that's never been the issue. The issue is, can you pitch 150 to 200 innings? We don't know, and we won't know.
And I'll add, if Garrett Whitlock's walking four guys, it's just not going to work. He can't afford to do that with his stuff. It's not good enough. He doesn't miss enough bats. So, but that's not Garrett Whitlock. Usually he is pounding the zone. So I don't know. That's what I circle back to on that.
Jaron Duran is a difference maker, made a diving catch with one out, first and second, runners at first and second in the fifth inning. There was Mike Trout with Weissert on the mound. Detmers shoved it up the Red Sox ass, which I
you definitely had that one.
Yeah, I could see that coming from a mile away. He went six innings, 94 pitches, three hits, one earned, walked one, and punched out 12. Pablo Reyes fumbles, another play Story makes. That was with runners at first and second, two outs. It was a shovel pass to second base. Runner was safe, and that loaded the bases. And then, which we mentioned, and then the Devers E5 fucks the whole game. But on a positive note to end it, Justin Slayton, filthy. Filth factory, two innings, 26 pitches, no hits, no runs, no walks. He faced six batters and struck out five of them. The Red Sox offense, not to, because I know, Coley, you did not want me to blame this entirely on Rafael Devers. The Red Sox offense did not have a hit after the fourth inning.
Yeah.
And it was Devers.
At that point, four out of nine games, not four out of 10 games, they've scored one run or less in regulation. We know Devers. Huh?
I said, well, you complained about it enough to where they heard you in the series finale. Yeah.
For sure. And if they had just spread those runs out a little bit more, we're talking about a sweep here. But yeah, four out of 10 games, 40% of their games, they've scored one run or less in regulation. That's not good enough. Like, that's, we can talk about the defense all we want. I look at two runs in this game. You should be able to beat the Angels. I don't care how dialed in Reed Detmers was. Like, that was bad. It's been bad four out of 10 times. The offense has just not showed up at all. And even in the other game, what they won, 4-2 and 2-1. Is that two of their wins as well? So it's not like they've been lighting the world on fire. They do it thrice now. They've scored eight or more.
6-4. They lost 1-0.
Yeah.
Lost 2-1.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Excuse me. 1-2-1. They got walked off. They got walked off 4-3 by the Mariners.
Yeah.
They won 5-1. 9-0, they beat the A's.
Yeah.
5-4, they beat the A's. 1-0, they beat the A's, which was crazy. 8-6, they beat the Angels. And then 2-1, they beat the A's.
2-1.
2-1, they lost the Angels.
Yes. So I just need, and stats, again, as pointed out, they are shooting a lot of stuff. The opposite field, it looks like they're just trying to get on, use their speed, all that. I know it's also not every, like, the batter does not get to dictate always where they hit it. That's not how this goes. But yeah, when Casas roped one off the wall, what was that, game one, and then he went fucking 440, whatever the fuck it was, on his home run. That's more what I'm trying to see. Like, swing the bat. Even Valdez. Like, I don't need Valdez trying to get on base and mix things up. That's a Rafaela Duran thing. They should be doing that. Everyone else, swing a big stick.
The lineup needs to get going. Obviously, they did in the finale, but it does suck defensively when these things stack up on top of each other. Like, when it's back-to-back, which the Red Sox have a tendency to do. It seems like if one guy messes up, the next one's coming quickly. Happened in Seattle, happens in Anaheim, and, you know, you look at that alone, you're 9-1 if you just make those normal plays. So, and Jared, I think you would tweet this, and it's a good point. Like, it's, we're not even asking for that much, and they're a 9-1 team, but it's still okay that they're 7-3. Like, it's, I'm glad that we're, that they're at 7-3, so it's not like you needed all these things to go right just to be a 500 team. Like, the pitching has been well enough, and the lineup's been good enough as well.
Yeah.
Even the second, like, we talk about Valdez a lot. He has an expiration date of a couple of weeks here, and that's when Vaughn comes. And listen, Tyler, you can make that
What's
face
the latest
all you want.
On Grissom?
I like Vaughn.
What's the latest on his timetable?
It's not worse than Valdez. It's supposed to be like the 25th, somewhere around there.
Okay.
Yeah, late April. I'm not saying I don't believe in Vaughn Grissom, because I like that move and I think he has potential. But all I can go off of, and this is part of my concern here, whoever he's going to be with at shortstop, he has not used as a double play partner before.
Sure.
So you're going to have an adjustment there. I think if you had Story there, it's like, all right, well, this is a guy who is one of the better defensive shortstops in baseball. Sure. You can work together to kind of make that happen. Well, if it's friggin' David Hamilton at shortstop or Pablo Reyes, for a guy that looked very rough at second base, per Lou Maroney, who, you know, I give him credit saying the arm angle was weird. They were talking to people down there that were a little cautious about it. It's just a guy who's more likely than not, at least for a bit, going to be another negative defender. It's going to be a guy figuring it out there. I think Grissom can become above average, but I'm not expecting that for a guy playing the position, you know, full time for the first time.
Their whole infield could be bad. Like,
I think Casas is at least an average.
Yeah, I'll give him that. But I'm just saying, if Casas trends down again, then it's like, who's good in the infield? If Rafael's not
where you were a year ago.
Yeah.
I don't know that, but that's not true. Like, even if Grissom, if it's just the arm angle, I mean, we have Valdez not even able to, like, field ground balls. You know,
he can't play baseball.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's just not what he does. It's not, not how his brain works. So that's where it's like, even if he's not like a gold glover, which I don't think anyone projects, you're still better with him there than Valdez. You know what I mean? That's where it's like, I can't say it's worse. And Hamilton, I'm willing to see. I trust the Sox prospect guys. They know better. I don't think they gave him defensive player of the year in the minors, like, for shits and giggles. I don't think they just did that for no reason.
When you have Sadon Rafael in your system, you definitely did.
What's the point of that? Why would they do that, though? What's to gain?
Who's his trade value? Like, I don't.
It's an acknowledgement. Like, they've talked about this with certain awards, though. Sometimes it can be an acknowledgement of, hey, this guy put a lot of work in. And David Hamilton did put a lot of work in. No one ever thought he was going to be able to play shortstop at all. And the fact that he can fake it there is pretty impressive.
He's here now.
Itself. Yeah, he's up in the big leagues. But it was so bad last year, they told him to go fuck off. And
did they literally do that? Do you know if they did that, Tyler?
Who said that specifically?
That's what he told me.
Who said it? Do you know who said it?
When he got demoted, that was it. It was
who,
like, all right,
said it? We want names, dude.
It was AC. AC sat him down and told him right to his face, go fuck off.
Wow.
But that's just where I get, and I like what Hamilton brings with speed and those different things. It's just to expect him to go out there, and I already saw him botch one ball early on. I'm like, all right, here we go again. This feels very uneasy, like it was for a lot of these guys a year ago. You lost that consistency where a ball got hit to Story and you didn't think about it.
Listen, I was one of the few people all offseason saying just sign Matt Chapman and move Devers to DH. Team didn't like that idea. Here we are.
It was an option.
Red Sox.
I can't have people complaining about Rafael Devers' defense when I tell you, all right, then move him to DH, and everyone goes, you can't pay him to play DH. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like, so stop talking. Like, I'm done talking about Rafael Devers' defense. We know it's bad.
I don't think you think as much about it when you have someone next to him who's going to make the plays and that can help him going to his left, which he tends to struggle with sometimes.
I mean,
now you don't have
that. He botched that play. Was it in Oakland where, or was it the first game of this series where it looked like he was like alley-ooping it to Story? Like, that still didn't get turned. And I don't blame Story for that at all, obviously, but it's like, I don't know that it matters. I don't, like, he was bad with everybody.
I think he was a bit better with Story next to him last year. I think we saw the bottom, him bottom out without Story, and then it was at least serviceable down the stretch. He got out of whatever horrendous hole he was in, you know, when he was crying in Houston.
Series finale. First thing here. They called it a single, but that's an E6 on Hamilton in the second inning.
They called that a single? I missed that.
Yeah.
What, because the ball was hit hard?
Yeah, pretty much.
Single.
That was an E6.
Exit velo.
Second line, I take it back. Hamilton is great. First career home run. Third inning, 1-0 Sox. Then I said about damn time. Devers helps out. Home run. This is also in the third inning. 2-0 Sox. Legitimate question. Is Tyler O'Neill the best offseason addition by any team? Home run in the third inning. 3-0 Sox. I mean, as of right now, the answer is yes.
Yeah.
No team that was added by their respective team this past offseason has made a greater impact than Tyler O'Neill. Fair or unfair?
Fair.
Super fair.
More than fair. It's the only right-handed hitter you have.
Better than Juan Soto?
So far.
Mm. So far?
I'll give it to him.
Reese cannot stop spanking it. 3-run home run. This is in the sixth inning to make it 7-0. And this is where I wrote QB1. He's my QB1.
I think part of the reason he's QB1 is because they're having trouble generating offense. And a guy they know right now who's hot, who's going to go rack up a couple hits. Now he's fucking
hitting
homers.
He can hit for average. He can hit for power.
You need it. You need good at bats right now.
I feel like he's not a garbage time hitter either. He's kind of just like, he's a step on the throat kind of hitter. He's like, oh, you guys need a big whack to put an end to this. I got you. And he comes in, gets the job done.
You also want to talk about someone getting credit for shit they didn't do. Connor Wong, pal. 0-for-3 throwing guys out at second. They called Anthony Rendon out because they just assumed he wanted to go sit down anyways. But
yeah,
quick 0-for-3.
Yeah. Going to do you an absolute solid here. Tanner Houck. 6 innings, 99 pitches, 4 hits, 0 earned runs. Did walk 2, but he struck out 7. And that was after striking out 10. In his season debut, T-Dog, any notes on Tanner Houck's pitch mix?
Yeah, so the four-seamer, he threw 1. So it's still basically
they're
gone.
Saying, fuck your four-seam.
They don't want to see it. And it got smacked. The sinker usage is up 7%. And I think where you see that is his ground ball rate is 64%, by far the highest of his career. And that's what Tanner Houck should be. Go let them smack the ball into the ground. And that's why he got through those first 3 innings where he had traffic or whatever. And he's missing bats like he did in 2020 and 2021. I don't know how you look at what he's doing and you aren't excited. I'd like to see it against better competition, obviously. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that was a lineup with a lot of righties. I think they had 7 in that day. Let's see what it looks like when there's more lefties stacked against them. But this is the best thing you could ask out of Tanner Houck. He looks great.
I don't even, like, most of the league's not better competition. Most of the league's bad. So it's really just keep pitching. That's all I want to see out of Tanner Houck. Just keep pitching.
I am excited at the bare minimum that we can get rid of that once they play the Orioles. It's like, all right, if they beat the Orioles, everybody shut up. Like, I'm sick of the bad competition thing is getting a little bit tiring. And it feels like this has been a month-long road trip. I'm so happy that tomorrow, it's honestly not even going to, on Tuesday, it's not going to feel real. It's like, oh, they actually get to play home games. Like, that's part of what happens when you play a major league season. But I was looking up the playoff percentages on FanGraphs. Mariners 44%, A's 1%, Angels 16%, and the Red Sox are up to 35%. That was up from 17% to start the season. So it's like, I get it. Those teams are all not expected to make the playoffs that they've played, but just after this series, everybody shut up.
That's, yeah. I haven't so much been annoyed by it because I agree. Like,
it's not fully wrong. I'm just sick of hearing it.
They had, what, the same record as the Angels going into that series?
Yes.
Yeah, the Angels
had
a winning
streak.
That's what I put
it out. Who talked about the Red Sox and Angels? They were like grouped into the same category. They're like, yeah, these are teams that are probably a little worse than 500.
Right.
You know, they're going to win 77 or 78 games. They don't have enough pitching to get by. This is kind of just be what it is. And then people after they go and take 2 out of 3 are like, oh, that team is fucking horrendous. That's crazy. The Mariners, easily people view them as a better team than you. They won 88 games. The A's fucking blow. We know. The Angels, you guys are the same
series
level.
Series win, like, for the A's in Detroit.
Yeah. And that's another interesting
point,
too. Everyone
was blowing the Tigers, too. Tigers, everyone's like, ooh, Detroit. Undefeated. Oh, it's the Tigers here. Ooh, la-di-da. Next thing you know, the A's wiped their ass with the Tigers.
And what were they doing about the Tigers?
They were like, ooh, la-di-da. They were doing that. And it's like, listen, why did they weren't a legit threat against the Red Sox, but now it's like, oh, yeah, well, against the Tigers, look out for the Oakland A's. Jesus Christ. So at least to Steve's point, they play the O's, they beat them, and we take it from there. Another Sedan Rafaela triple. Tyler, where are the nipples?
I should have pulled them out. Should I just post my like tits every time something like that happens on the timeline?
Do it now? Should he have to do it the next show? Or what's?
No, like, okay, I think you should just selfie
live
tits out. Yeah. Like,
if it feels wrong if it's not on stream, though. Like, I think when we stream, that's
feels
what
good.
People are hungry.
Nope, feels good.
You can start streaming if there's a triple hit. I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
It streams out, for dude. 20 seconds, flashes.
And no, then the stream. From whenever it's hit to the right end of the game, I think he has to stream. Like, if you get a Durant leadoff triple, you're basically streaming the whole game.
Yeah. Yeah, we need nip for trip.
I can offer more. And I'll give credit, Rafaela coming in the sixth inning. Have yourself a freaking game, a triple, and then a two-run single as well for a guy who's been struggling at the plate.
Yeah.
I think that's what you're asking for.
Bases
loaded.
Give me
those opposite field.
Yeah, he followed that up with a bases loaded two-run knock in the ninth to make it 11-1. Five RBI for Reese. And that was in the ninth inning. He added another one, so make it 12-1. I put Red Sox should have swept. It's just how I feel, Coley. It's just how I feel.
I don't disagree. They just should have scored more runs in game two, and they would have swept.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No, like, I'll never feel bad when you only score one run. Like, whatever else happens feels irrelevant to me. One run's not nearly enough.
But, you know, you score 8 in one game and then you score 12 in the other, right?
Like, yeah, we smacked them.
of course. So go squeeze one out. Go win one with pitching and defense, right? Like, that's the difference.
Just average.
You weren't able to do that.
Average, like, 6 runs a game. Just do that. Just score 6 every game.
That's not every night, though.
What was the thing a few years ago? Was it like just score 5?
Just score 4.
Just score 4.
Just score 4.
It rhymed.
Yeah, they were smacking people as long as they scored 4.
Yeah, you score 4, they were like 90%. They would win. 95%. It was crazy. Yeah, yeah. It is, Jerry. That's the right reaction because it's like 4 runs and they were.
Yeah, 4.
Yeah, that was it.
The fuck?
That was
it. Just score 4.
Wow.
And that's, you look at this game, they win 4-2 if they had scored 4.
This feels like a just score 4 team. That's what they're showing you so far. So
big time.
Maybe we bring just it back. 4.
I will say, and this goes into the score 4, Craig Breslow and what he did to this bullpen, not getting talked about enough.
Talk about
it
right now,
talk
Tyler.
About it.
Talk about it.
Talk
the
about
last,
it.
the last couple of years, like Heim would find these guys, right? It was usually one a year, Bernardino, Schreiber, Whitlock. Dude, Craig Breslow showed up. He got you Isaiah Campbell, Greg Weissert, and Justin Slayton. And was just like, enjoy, have fun. Greg Weissert was sitting in AAA. Isaiah Campbell was a low leverage guy in Seattle, and Justin Slayton was a Rule 5 pick. I think Justin Slayton, he could arguably be your second best reliever by the end of this year. Core called him Whitlock after the game. He's like, that's 2021 Whitlock. It's the greatest compliment you could give to a Rule 5 guy, and he's missing bats at a ridiculous rate. Isaiah Campbell, I have no fear of that guy in a high leverage spot. And Greg Weissert, he's your fireman. He comes in whether it's a bad situation or whatever and you feel good about it. I don't know. Talk about rebuilding a bullpen on the fly. And you got Campbell for freaking Luis Urias, who you were going to non-tender no matter what. You didn't give a fuck one way or the other about him. Like, and Weissert was a throw-in in the Verdugo deal.
Right.
He was a quadruple A arm for them. And Slayton, credit to them, they fucking couldn't stop talking about it when it happened. And he showed up and he's done exactly that. He's been dominating since the spring. This guy was walking 4.5 in the minors per 9. He hasn't walked one guy this year.
I'm going to be furious when they try him out as a starter next year. Furious.
I don't even like the multi-innings. It makes me nervous with him. I'll be real, because he just feels like a one-inning go. But
they all feel like one inning. That's kind of the other problem. Other than Winkowski, I don't really love when I see someone coming out for multiple innings of any of these guys.
I don't even love Wink.
No, but him I trust. Him I trust more than the rest of them.
Jake?
The Clark's Ketchup Series MVP, brought to you by Clark's Ketchup. Drizzle that ketchup. It is tightly contested, I will say, from the votes that were submitted. First vote. And I fucking forgot to get the Survivor music. I'm sorry. Next series when I'll have it. I'm sorry. I fucked up.
Accept your apology.
I fucked up. That's on me. That's on me.
Oh.
Oh!
Has to happen. When Steve's unprepared, when Tyler's unprepared, they get suspended.
I gotta say, I was a little worried when he revoked his previous suspension that Jared was gonna try to go suspensionless all season. This is accountability. This is what you ask for. Incredible.
I still wouldn't be shocked if down the line he tries to revoke this one. You never know with that guy. He
likes to revoke. It's in play. Thinking about it. But it's in play.
In the moment, you gotta give credit where it's due. You lead from the front, Jerry. You lead from the front.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
It's getting sent right to the box.
I won't get suspended for.
No, I'm not going to grant you. definitely not granting you immunity, but proceed. Okay.
Listen. Yeah. I'm not saying Coley will ever get suspended, but do you believe, Coley, you could be suspended?
For sure. Yeah,
of course.
I was pushing the button earlier today. I thought I was getting tossed in the box.
Coley, I mean, we disagreed pretty strongly about the role that Devers played in losing that middle game.
Well, it's like takes usually don't get you suspended. It's like bringing up Eataly.
No, that's not true. I feel like Tyler has some takes that I will toss his ass for.
Well, his takes are like known. We don't say that here.
Right.
Yeah, Coley's not going to be trying to trade the whole roster. So, like, there's...
Guy, matter of fact, get him out.
I'm not getting suspended.
Dude was licking his chops seeing what Tyler O'Neill did in this series. He was like, oh my God, how many fucking top 50 prospects can I get for Tyler O'Neill in a three-team trade? He was already drafting it up. Crazy, Tyler.
This guy, this team, like the 27 Yankees, he's like, let's break them up. Let's literally break them up.
Yep, get Garrett out of here. Yep.
Trade. I got to say, that's a tough suspension because it's for a former take, right? You can get suspended. Yeah,
he got suspended because he was thinking it. You could tell he was thinking it.
It was a thought exercise, and it was taken as fact.
Yeah, well, don't think so much.
I think every series they went like, I'm not saying every series the rest of the season, but if they... Until they lose the series, I think he gets suspended every series.
Just for
can I ponder a thought?
Yeah.
Proceed with caution, but yes.
All I'm saying is I had this team at 79 wins. Coley had them at 70. So with that attitude, you are trading everything.
Listen,
that's all I'm saying.
That's a projection. We're living in, now that we've seen it, there's been new information.
I'm not arguing that, but I'm just saying it's a thought. It's something that's in the back of your mind at times.
No, it isn't. That was what I thought preseason. I'm a big moron.
So you're just that. You won't even think about possibly moving things at the deadline.
Let's fucking get there, bud.
Three, dude.
Let's get there.
They're 7-3.
I like to look ahead.
Yeah, but you're looking ahead negatively.
I look at it both ways, positive and negative, so I can never be surprised.
Positive, like the top prospects we're going to get back for Tyler O'Neill. That's the positivity you view.
Are we extending Tyler O'Neill?
I've said this online, and I hate to delay the Clark's Ketchup MVP like this to
on the web
do this, but he very much feels like a Cody Ross, Adam Duvall, in the sense that like every once in a while we just get one of these guys who Adrian Beltre. Perfect Red Sox who, for whatever reason, only like the MLB has this unwritten rule like, nope, certain right-handed hitters are only allowed to play one season at Fenway Park. Just one.
And I want to just enjoy this too. Like, if he keeps going on this run, I don't want to think about next year. Let's just keep having fun with what he's doing this year, you know?
Yeah, I'm having fun.
A lot of fun.
It's about fun, man.
Mm-hmm.
And Tyler, you have the same name as him. That's crazy. How about
that? Yeah, you guys have the same name, dude.
T-Dogs stick together.
Exactly.
Yeah. Anyways, Lou Maloney's in for Tyler O'Neill. Dave O'Brien?
Oh, I was hoping to. I thought we were going to hear from Lou. Damn it.
Well, like, we have a submission from Will Fleming.
Okay.
Yeah. Dave O'Brien says, a little love for Reese McGuire.
So Reese is talking about.
He gave himself a little love, yeah.
Folks.
Mm-hmm.
Tugging on the heartstrings.
Jemai Webster. Tyler O'Neill. Kevin Youkilis. Reese McGuire. So what's that? One vote
You've got them right in front of you.
Well, I don't tally them. I'm going through my text messages right now.
It's 2-2.
I thought you wrote them in a list.
Jake's
no.
got it.
No, I literally just go through my text messages. And it was like days ago that I got the information.
Fair.
Yeah. So usually like it's like right before the fucking show and then I can just pull them all up. But now like Will Middlebrooks submitted his vote after the game, but then we also talked today. So now he's at the top, but like OB's at the bottom.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Gimme Hammerin' Hank Aaron McGuire. Another vote for Reese McGuire. Is he leading?
Yeah.
Yep.
That's three for Reese.
Mm-hmm.
Three for Reese, two for Tyler O'Neill.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. All right. So we have Jemai, we have Will, we have OB. Oh, TC. What did TC say? From Tom Karen. Jaren Durant. No. Tyler O'Neill. Well, I read his. He voted the first Ketchup of the year. He voted for Durant.
Correct. Yeah.
Tyler O'Neill, lots of candidates, but I like homers, he said. Tyler O'Neill for TC. So what is it now? 3-3?
Yeah.
Wow, 3-3. So that brings us to Will Fleming, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
We got Loomer, we got Uke, we got TC, we got OB, we got Will, we got Jemai.
Did you actually read Will's?
Will is a fucking voice submission.
Oh.
Yes.
Saint Marcelo, broken halo, golden wings that he used to fly.
How the hell are we, fellas, from Southern California? Once again, it is time to drizzle. Now, what a first trip for these Red Sox. 7-3. Yes, the Trevor Story injury absolutely sucks. There's no getting around that. But what a way to start the season. Lou is too soft. He flew home. He missed the Anaheim series. So it's just me solo here for the Clark's Ketchup Series MVP. And a sure sign of a great series for the Red Sox. Lots of people to choose from. Tanner Houck was unbelievable today. Reese McGuire, of course, hits a couple of big home runs in the series. Jaren Duran set the tone, even without the blonde hair. Big, big swings and defense in game one. I think Justin Slayton has closer-type stuff. We're going to be talking about him all season long. But for me, in this spot, almost like a season achievement award, the guy whose biceps are bigger than my waist, a guy who hit two more home runs again in this series, an absolute monster who's doing Adam Duvall-type things at the plate to start the season with elite defense. The Clark's Ketchup Series MVP is Tyler motherfucking O'Neill.
Yeah!
Good stuff.
All right, so where does that leave us, Jake?
We got four for Tyler O'Neill, three for Reese McGuire.
Wow. It is a tight race. It is a tight race. All right. Now that brings it to us. It's five more votes. One vote separates these individuals. Tyler, who are you voting for Clark Ketchup Series MVP?
I'm going with Tyler O'Neill. He did start all three games. You're talking three homers, right? Overall, obviously Reese only had two, but Reese had more RBIs. Where I will penalize Reese, there was a little bit of stat sheet stuffing in that last game. That game was well over and he was just cleaning up. And I respect the go get your numbers. But I think if we're talking moments where, you know, Tyler O'Neill got the Red Sox offense going or started, it was him in multiple games in this series. I'm going with T-Dog.
Call it.
I mean, we talked about it earlier. Tyler O'Neill. Love the guy. Maybe the most selfish player on the team. Five home run, five RBI. He's all about me, me, me. Duran's home run in that first game won them that game.
Correct.
But he also has poop brains, so I'm not going with him. I'm going with the home run that won them game three, which is the only reason we're talking about Ketchup. They lose game three coming off the bad vibes. You know what I mean? They lose Story. They lose game two. The vibes were not high. One man and one man alone restored those vibes, hitting a home run over his fucking head to start that game. Jared?
No, I was just You said one
he was
man.
He was doing one man. Yeah,
one man.
Doing
one man.
One man. Yep.
One man.
David Hamilton is my vote.
Wow.
The vibe restore. This team is 7-3 based off vibes and vibes only. We can talk about Bailey, talk about all these guys. Cora dubbed them the Vibe Sox early and often. The vibes were in the fucking gutter when Trevor Story's arm exploded on the field. And David Hamilton restored them with one swing of the bat.
Okay. Steve?
Yeah. Speaking of vibes, I think this guy has added to the vibes. I think this guy has fit in perfectly well on the Boston Red Sox. He had an 1871 OPS in this series. Three bombs, three RBIs. He does not drive anyone in but himself because that's what he loves to do. Two walks, six runs. He'll score runs. You can drive him in, but he's not driving you in. Mm-mm. Tyler O'Neill, series MVP.
Wow. Jake?
Yeah, I'm going Tyler O'Neill. He hits a home run every time he gets up. I don't care if it's a solo home run. Like, eventually, it's going to be a more than that if he just keeps hitting home runs. So, T-Dog.
The odds are high that they're not all going to be solo.
Imagine if he hits 40 solo home runs this year.
Didn't Bryce Harper do that like a couple of years ago?
It was close, yeah.
Schwarber has had a couple of those low RBI, big homer seasons.
Yeah. I'm also going Tyler O'Neill. He is the Clark's Ketchup Series MVP for the 2 out of 3 against the Halos in Anaheim. The series that we will look back on that should have been a sweep if not for an E5 by Rafael Devers. That was the only thing that prevented this from being a sweep was an E5.
Even that's not true. The Reyes thing could have easily just ended that inning.
Yeah, we actually didn't rip Reyes enough for taking forever to just flip the ball.
I had it in
base.
The notes.
It was in the notes, but Devers catching a lot of flack.
I think it deserved a little more.
Yeah.
Yeah. Reyes was first to mess up. So.
Yeah. And even my sweetest youngest lad, Rafael, if he just catches a pop fly, it's all avoided.
I did love Rafael there, like looking at the up, like, come on, transfer. They show the replay. I'm like, dude, that is not even close to in the transfer. Like, you dropped it. He can be a little too cool out there. I hope this is one of those lesson learned. We're not having that happen again.
Yeah, do that again. We'll give you another $50 million, bucko. Knock it off.
Actually, Chewy did that. He signed a good deal.
Yeah.
That pushed them over the edge. They're like, okay.
All right. This guy's cool.
It was 55 before that. They were like, all right.
Yeah.
Can we talk about the fact that the Red Sox are coming home 7-3? I crazy. Picked them to lose 3 out of 4 against Seattle in the first series of the season.
You did.
And to go from that to like pissed off that they're not 9-1 is quite the leap.
It's absurd.
Quite the
leap. If you told all of us 5-5, I think we would have been like, yeah, absolutely.
Fuck yeah, dude. Yeah, we'll take 5-5. Yeah.
I mean, we had 30-0 on the brain.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
But this being the longest road trip of the season, as TC pointed out during the series, it feels like they've set themselves on the right path to have a more successful season. Like we saw it in 19, you have a shit West Coast start to start a season. It kind of ruins the rest of the season.
It does. Not even like fully kidding. And we talked about that in 8. Yeah.
2019.
Like, yeah. 19 just like
wasn't
that completely
part of that international as well.
No.
Oh, they also had to go to London in June or whatever it was. Yeah.
Yeah.
They started the season fucking 20 games on the West Coast, and then in June they had to go to, I believe, London and then Toronto and then back to like they had to be like three countries.
Exactly.
Yeah, Manfred was like, "Fuck this team!
You are not going back to back. No chance.
No chance."
In July.
I forgot they went to Toronto. What a fucking asshole!
Yeah, they were in three countries in 3 days, and. The league did not want back-to-back championships. They're like, we see what this team just did. This team just won 119 games. Like, we got to make it as difficult as possible. And the Red Sox were like, you know what? We're packing it in. Like, that team, they were getting booed getting their World Series rings. That's how bad it was by the time they got home.
Awkward as hell. The fact that the Sox only have one game the rest of the year that's later than the 8 o'clock hour. Yeah, they only have one more home game, actually. So
yeah.
Yeah.
Just get ready for that. We only got it's Tuesday. That's it. After that, it's the rest is on the road. So just get ready. Be excited.
Yeah. Yeah. They just play a quick just 155 on the road.
Yep. A quick one gamer against the O's at Fenway and then 155 straight.
What year is that they I think it was the Royals where like they had to come home and play one home game because it was like a makeup.
Mm.
Like the Royals literally came in for one game and then left. Do you remember that?
Oh yeah, I do vaguely. I can't remember though. Can't remember. What
I think it was 21.
It may have been.
Yeah, something like that. Anyways, the Stop and Shop Look Ahead brought to you by what, Tyler? Are you kidding me, dude? No, no. No, no, you don't like imagine putting your finger up during the intro or like putting your finger up during the Clark's Ketchup song. Like I was in the middle of Stop and Shop Look Ahead and you're just like,
Tyler, like, I'm not trying to be mean here. Tyler kind of abuses the finger up.
He's very smart. Well, it's not that. It's just he lacks feel.
No feel.
And you know what? And you know what, Coley? Hey, Coley, you know what? Ready?
Keep going.
This is for me. This is for me.
Why?
Wow, for raising your hand when I was...
Oh.
Nope.
What's going on here?
As the person who's trying to get this show on the fucking tracks right now, we've done no haikus, and we're 145 in. Okay. We're 145 in, and you're going to the freaking Stop and Shop Look Ahead, and we haven't done a fucking haiku yet. Listen,
fair.
That sucks.
That's it.
That sucks, but it's a fair point. That sucks.
Thank you. I just didn't want to start looking ahead before we did what was before. No.
You're right. Suspension for the people at home. I feel like Tyler's suspension is rescinded.
Thank you.
He was right,
but I also suspended myself without him having to say what it was for. So
you know, you're not wrong, but I do think you get suspended and also his is rescinded. I think that's done.
Welcome to the Tycoos.
What?
No! Stop and Shop Look Ahead.
What the hell was that?
This guy starts. Yeah, no one starts high stepping at the 50 more than Milliken. He's like, I've got some green in front of me, and he just fucking trips and fumbles out of bounds.
Oh my god. Oh, man.
So muted.
Okay, I'm free. Hello. Brunettes have more fun. Please let Story be okay. O'Neill, take the wheel. Reese is spanking it. T-Dog Dong, play the ketchup song. Score on Hauk, you can. A series of haikus by Tyler Milliken. On the taiku front, that was asked by our YouTube audience. It was the most liked comment.
Hey,
I'm just saying.
I saw it, yeah. I saw it.
They're going to be hurt.
I think they'll appreciate how funny that was.
Yeah. Correct.
Coming right off a suspension. Bang.
Yeah.
Milliken from deep again. Bang. He's on fire.
Boom sauce.
Yeah, you got sauced on that one, unfortunately.
I apologize.
Don't apologize to me. I laughed. I got something out of it. I take a positive from it. So.
Thank you for acknowledging me.
I didn't like that tone.
I didn't really love that. Yeah, that's a warning. That's a warning. I mean.
Good.
just dying at the waist.
Do we have a problem?
Dying at
what?
Do we have a problem?
I'm walking off the mat and you're staring at me.
You're chirping.
Listen.
This is Joe West problem. And Madison Bumgarner right here. That's
this.
Go ahead.
I'm not going to do it.
No, I'm not asking to get suspended. Stop and shop, look ahead.
Oh. You don't tell me what to do. I'll sit here all Carry fucking on. Night. I don't care.
We're waiting.
The Stop and Shop, look ahead! Brought to you by Stop and Shop. Head on down to Stop and Shop. Use the promo code SECTION10 to get 10 cents off each one of your tangerines when you buy up to 5 pounds of tangerines. Only at Stop and Shop using the promo code SECTION10. It is opening day. Opening day at Fenway Park. Red Sox, Orioles. It is daytime Bayo. That's an L right off the bat. Brayan Bello versus Corbin Burns, who's unbelievable. L. And Nick Pivetta versus Cole Irvin. Cutter Crawford versus Grayson Rodriguez. These are some good pitching matchups I'm excited to see. Brayan Bello. Yeah. He faced the Orioles once last year. 5 innings, 7 hits, 3 earned. Did not walk a batter. 4 strikeouts. Didn't give up a home run. Got the win. This is his first day game of the year. As you know, last year, a 951 OPS allowed and a 694 ERA in day games last year. Not good. Something to keep an eye on. Corbin Burns, 1-0, a 231 ERA, an 086 whip, and a 10.8 strikeouts per nine. He had a dominant debut, going 6 innings with 11 strikeouts, only 1 run allowed. His second outing was very pieced together. 5 2/3, 9 innings, I mean, 9 hits, 2 earned runs, and 3 strikeouts. The Royals put the 23 balls in play when the Angels only managed 8. It's early, but his cutter is up 0.7 miles per hour from last year. 95.1 is the average, his best since 2021. Nick Pivetta, 1-1, an 0.82 ERA, an 0.82 whip, a 10.6 strikeouts per nine. Pivetta's season line would be 11 innings, 8 hits, 1 earned run, 1 walk, 13 strikeouts, 1 home run. J.P. Crawford's solo home run is the only run that he's allowed in 2 starts so far this year. A sweeper is gross. Hitters are 1-15. That one hit is a single, 8 strikeouts, while whiffing 33% of the time. He was more fastball heavy against the A's than he was in his first start, but still at 37%. 4 seamers. The A's had an expected slug of 699 off the 4-seam in that game, which is a little scary, but they only ended up 1-6 with a single. First start at home in 2024, hoping he can reverse his trends of 2023. An opponent's OPS at home last year of 720 versus 651 on the road. It's a 454 ERA at home last year compared to 356 on the road. Then you have Cole Irvin, 0-1 with a 720 ERA. Irvin has only made 1 start this year, and it was against the Royals. 5 innings, 7 hits, 4 earned, 2 walks, 3 strikeouts, took the L. The Royals hit the shit out of the ball against him. 19 batted balls, 11 of them were hard hit. 7 of them were over 100 miles an hour, 4 over 105. That is hitting the ball on the screws. So, yeah, he's a lefty and he's not good. So the Red Sox should fare pretty well, especially when Nicky Smooch is on the mound. Cutter Crawford. If I had a nickel for every time the two pitchers had an ERA that matched their whip, I'd have 2. Cutter and Pivetta. Season line so far, 10 2/3, 5 hits, 2 runs, 1 earned, 4 walks, 12 strikeouts. The 3 walks against the Angels were ugly. Came at a bad time. Cutter only allowed 1 hard-hit ball, though, on 12 in play. Grayson Rodriguez, famously a big arm prospect, stuck in the middle of all the bats that the Orioles have in their organization. Brutal beginning to his career last season. First 10 starts, a 735 ERA, a 590 FIP. But he turned it around after being sent back down. His final 10 starts,
2.41 ERA, 2.79 FIP, a 5.97 OPS against. The most runs he's allowed in a game in his good stretch did come against the Red Sox, 4 1/3, 7 hits, 4 runs, 2 of them earned. Did take the L. His 2024 stats have picked up where he left off, 12 1/3, 10 hits, 3 earned, 16 Ks. He has allowed 3 home runs, though. So there is that. Prediction time. I'm just going to go first. 2 out of 3 Sox. I think there's no chance they win on opening day. And then they take the next 2. Cole?
Last year, I bring it up a lot because he's only had such a young career. Bello went into that Yankees-Houston on the road stretch. Must win games, must win series. And he was like shaking Chris Sale by the shoulders, being like, it's time for us to step up and carry this team. I like that he was the opening day starter. I like that that lines up with him being the home starter. And I love that it's Corbin Burns on the other side of it. I think the day game shit from last year could rear its head throughout the season. I don't think it does this series. Gray Rod's the game I think they drop. I think they win the first 2. I have no excuses. If they don't score 45 fucking runs against Cole Irvin, you're basically, you get to play the A's again. Think of it that way. You were 3-0 against Cole Irvin last year. You faced him thrice. He didn't start all those games, but he pitched in 3 games against the Red Sox. They won all of those. I expect the same in game 2. Gray Rod terrifies me. I think he pieces us up kind of easily, even though it's righty against a team full of lefties. I don't know that it's going to matter much, but Burns, I think that looks like a 2-1 game that they squeak out. Orioles, the top of their lineup hasn't been producing like they did all of last year. So I think we're playing them at a right time.
Not yet.
Don't let them get right against us. That's all I care about.
No.
Well, I mean, you're not sending the fucking best message by having day game Bayo in the opener.
Like I said, I think of him more as like, who were those day games? Like we said, out in Oakland, he stinks because it's low stakes. He doesn't get up for that shit. That's not what gets him up in the morning. You're going up against a Cy Young candidate at home with a 7-3 team. This is the team. People are picking this team to go to the World Series. Let's carry that momentum. I'm riding with Bayo. And by the way, you can go over to Underdog Fantasy, punch in the code Carrabas, get up to a $100 deposit match bonus. If you feel like I feel, if you think those first 2 Bayo starts, again, he's given up runs on 3 swings. The rest of the swings have not resulted in runs. I think that's going to be more of the same more often than not in this Baltimore game. I think he's going to shove. I know I'm going higher on his Ks. I believe in Bayo, even if Jerry doesn't.
Nobody does.
People are out on Bayo.
Mm-hmm. This would be the spot, right? If there were a spot for him to like shove in a day game, home opener, contract extension, you're the leader of the rotation, this would be it. So I get that Burns is on the other side, but sometimes I think we look too much into the pitchers matching up, you know? Sox 2 out of 3, by the way. T-Dog? Do I have to wait to be called on? Is that?
No.
All right. Sox 2 out of 3. Excuse me. I'm interested to see how Rafaela performs in the first game post-extension, and just knowing that there's going to be a lot more eyes on him now. Does he move to short?
He's going to try harder because he got extended?
Not try harder, but that's a huge day for him, and it's home opener with a lot of expectations. How does he play center field at Fenway? Yeah, I think Sox win 2 out of 3, but it's being fanny, honestly. I'm being fanny here, and I'm kind of being wishful thinking. I think Tyler O'Neill hits a mega bomb, sets the tone, keeps that momentum
going.
What
defines a mega bomb? Like, what do you, like, is it a
end of the parking lot?
Like the garage across the street?
Yeah, the parking lot past Lansdowne.
Rob Refsnyder, the only player on the team that can do that.
Yeah, true.
You know, I think Tyler O'Neill can do
that. Well, we haven't seen.
I think he does that in this series, and I don't, this feels like more of a basketball thing where it's like, oh, they're doubting us to cut. I do wonder if this rotation's like, okay, a lot of people are going to be looking at how do we handle the Orioles lineup. And I think they're going to take this personally. And yeah, Sox 2 out of 3. Again, being fanny with this one.
Little fanny. Jake?
I got the Sox winning Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday for the sweet.
Yeah.
You got me there, Jake.
Am I up?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm going to go 1 out of 3 for the Red Sox in this series. I think the first game, I think Bayo and Burns are going to go at each other. I just feel like the Orioles coming in, they just lost 2 out of 3 to the Pirates. They're kind of pissed off. They're going to be looking to kind of get everything back on track. Cole Irvin, Red Sox have an ERA, or he has an ERA against the Red Sox above 4. I think that's an easy game, and I think Pivetta is going to show what he can do against a really good lineup. I'm with Coley on Grayson Rodriguez. I think that's a just tough matchup where he's kind of developing into that top of the rotation starter. I just feel like we're going to get one of those pitcher duels between Burns and Bayo. The bullpen hasn't leaked at all this year for the most part outside of Joely Rodriguez. I feel like there's some regression to come on that front, and I think more than it has to do with the pitchers, it's going to have to do with the defense. We're going to kind of be sitting there saying, damn, man, if someone was, or, you know, if Story was there, or if they just weren't such a disaster defensively the last couple games or so, you're in a better place. I think it's going to kind of build up a little bit, and that's going to become a storyline for them again.
Okay. All right. Call it.
The Angels are currently up 3-0 on the Tampa Bay Rays for people who want to shit on what the Red Sox pitching did.
Legit club. They're beating good teams.
Yep. Worst bullpen ERA in baseball right now, the Tampa Bay Rays.
Yeah. I mean, people only want to talk about the Red Sox competition when it fits their narrative. So, like, they'll probably say, Steve?
That should have been an eventual finger. Should we have versions of, like, after your point versus right now? Yeah. You're calling this. You're calling this.
You got to be ready to go.
Yeah.
Well, it's the weather look ahead, but
I'm sorry. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, weather look ahead. Sponsored by Billy's Gummy Beers. Also, speaking of sponsors on the show, Clark's Ketchup has an Instagram account now. Go ahead and follow Clark's Ketchup on Instagram. Jake, what's the handle? Is it just Clark's Ketchup?
Yeah, I'm pulling it up now, but it's got to be Clark's Ketchup.
It's at Clark's Ketchup, yeah.
Yep.
It's gotta be. Yeah. Follow Clark's Ketchup on Instagram. They put out great content. They put out awesome content nonstop. So
the weather look ahead brought to you by Billy's Gummy Bears.
Chew 'em with your mouth.
Chew 'em with your mouth. Opener, home opener Tuesday at Fenway Park, 2:10. p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It is going to be 55 degrees around first pitch, mostly cloudy. Kind of hate seeing that. It's going to be sunny before first pitch and then mostly cloudy around first pitch. 6% chance of rain, wind obviously from the north and the northeast at 9 miles an hour. Game 2 is the first night game at Fenway of the year, 7:10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That is on Wednesday night. Don't love the look of it. Might just be some passing showers. We'll see. 44 degrees, 45% chance of rain. Hopefully the rain is later in the night so it doesn't mess with that game. Thursday, guys. Thursday, not looking great. Same time.
Thursday is not looking great.
7:10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Thursday night, 50 degrees.
Steve, sorry to interrupt. Can I just say how happy I am to have 7 o'clock baseball games back in my life?
Huge. And then get them back and it's going to be.
What?
Finale doesn't look great.
It's going to be like a rain delay.
96% chance of rain on Thursday night.
So you think there's going to be no game?
Maybe. I don't
know. Well, you're the weather guy. I mean, I just. You know,
no, is it a rain delay? 3 days out of stuff.
I mean, listen. If I have tickets to the game on Thursday, am I expecting a rain delay? Like, am I going to go?
Yes, you should probably expect a delay.
Or am I like, oh, I have tickets to the Red Sox game on Thursday. Should I make other plans because they're probably not going to play today? What if I'm coming from the great state of Maine, right? Like, what if I don't have the luxury of being down the street where it's like, yeah, I'll drive in and have a couple beers and. And then drive home, you know, like, what are you, you know, like,
you know what,
I'm
saying?
What am I supposed? Yeah.
Delay likely, potential rain out for the finale on Thursday.
So that's not telling me anything, Steve.
That's telling you a lot.
Potential rain out, but potential.
Calling a rain out. I'm never going to call a rain out 3 days ahead. Not going to do that. The forecast changes too much in 3 days.
All right. Yeah. Yeah, explain that to the people in Maine then.
If you want to take the risk and come on down to Fenway Park, then it might be a rainout on.
What if Coley's neighbor is just like, hey, Coley, you do that podcast with the weather guy, right? Am I good for Thursday? Am I good? You must know. Like, you do a podcast with the weather guy, right?
No, that's that. Jared, I'm giving you my honest opinion. That's a, it's your call.
Your honest opinion is who fucking knows. And that's not good.
No, enough. My honest opinion is there's a chance that that game gets rained out. And that's your call.
There's a chance there could be a fucking hurricane. There's a chance there could be a tornado.
I'm not saying a tsunami.
Yeah, there's a chance that there could be a blizzard. Like, you know, there's
no
a
blizzard.
Chance of all
no
of
blizzard.
It.
I'm not seeing that. No blizzard for the finale.
So you got 0%
that.
On the blizzard.
0% blizzard for the
you
finale.
You better pray to God there's not a blizzard. You better pray to whatever God you believe in that there's not a blizzard. Blizzard on Thursday. Throwing a 0% like that in New England when talking weather. That's crazy.
I would say 0% blizzard, 50% rain out.
You can't even go
51. You percentages. What do you
want? Like, I'm just saying, like, you can't even like go like 49% to be like, it's not the majority, but it's a strong chance.
Oh, wait.
Going 50-50 is
49.6% chance of a rainout.
It's the most chicken shit weatherman thing that you can do.
That's what I'm doing. 50%.
You're a terrible weatherman.
That's mean.
Go ahead. Continue.
No, that's it. That'll do it.
Well, I'm just worried about Thursday now.
Very worried.
I know. I am too. We, to your point, Jared, we finally get 7 o'clock games back. I don't want to be recording it at 1 in the morning.
I mean... I get it, dude. I don't listen. What is Thursday? What do I have going on Thursday?
Sox.
Sox potentially.
Thursday is the 11th. Yeah, I mean, all I got is the Sox on my schedule.
That's it.
Same.
That's all I'm saying. I believe it's Jason Veritek's birthday. Correct me if I'm wrong. Let's see, Jason Veritek birthday. It is. It's Jason Veritek's birthday. And because it's Jason Veritek's birthday, that also means it's Trot Nixon's birthday. Hold on. Let me double check that one. Trot Nixon birthday. It is. It's Trot Nixon's birthday as well. So I've got Sox, Tech, Trot on Thursday. And you're telling me
50% chance of rainout.
We don't know if we're going to play baseball that day.
Yeah, I don't know.
Let me ask Jake. Jake, what do you think about Thursday? You think we're playing ball or what?
Based on the report, I have no fucking idea.
He's right. He's right, by the way. That is the correct way to look at it.
Oh, man. Yeah, I mean, listen, honestly, this is my fault. Like, I took Steve's weather segment away from last week, and he's just playing it safe this week because he knows I can't fuck this one up. I can't fuck this
I'm
one up.
I'm not intentionally playing this safe. I'm playing this as 50, what I 50, think.
50-50, there's no such thing as 50-50 in weather. Weather, they teach you that day one in weather school. There's no such thing as 50-50.
Yeah, I should have remembered that. That's right.
Yeah. There is either a chance it's happening or a chance it's not. There's
Want
no
me
such
to update
thing
it?
As 50-50. When are you going to update it? Now?
Yeah, 51% chance rain out.
You're going from less to more.
Exactly.
It's not even consistent. At least trend in the same direction.
If I were to lean one way, then I'll say there's a 1% more than chance that
Jared,
it gets rained out.
Jared.
Can you read the weather report again for Thursday?
What's the radar?
Yeah.
It doesn't sound good, but a lot of times
changes. Steve. From the top, Thursday.
50 degrees, Thursday night, around first pitch, 7:10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time at Fenway Park. Uh-huh. Showers early, becoming a steady rain late. There's 96% chance of rain, but that can change, Jared.
On the hourly, what time does the rain start and what time does it become steady?
The hourly doesn't go that far.
What model are you using?
We're 62 hours out.
Okay. When does, in your opinion, because obviously I'm not a professional.
No, you're not.
Weather guy. I'm not. Hand up, I'm not. Mm-hmm. How close to the weather event do you have to get before you can get in? Like, where's like
10
the,
minutes.
Where's the,
typically
no,
a full see, day from what
see,
I'm looking
where
at.
Where is
yeah.
the red zone of hourly?
You Looks know? Like, I know. You want the answer?
Yes.
It is 30, around 30 hours. No, maybe 36 hours. It's like a day and a half.
Do we do an emergency podcast on Wednesday? Like, do we come back just to figure out what the hell is happening on Thursday?
Might have to. Yeah. I don't want to make it seem like I don't care about Ted and Maine.
I know you care. I know you care. It's just like, I don't. Here's the thing, right?
Yeah.
I know you care.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to care more than you. Then it's a problem.
Okay.
That's when it's a problem.
Huge.
That's fine.
I can't care. If I'm sitting here, right, and I'm just talking socks, that's my job.
Yep.
Your job is the weather.
That's literally the only reason I'm here. Yeah.
I can't care more about what happens on Thursday in terms of precipitation than you.
I don't think
that's
you do
when
care
we
more.
Have a problem.
I don't think you do care more.
All right.
That's all I'm saying.
All right. Tyler?
What were the odds of the tsunami again?
100%, apparently.
No, 0%. Tsunami, 0%.
Thank you.
Tsunami is zero. Blizzard is zero.
Yep. Rain out
what about
51.
Tornado? Call it, tsunami, blizzard.
Earthquake?
5%. I'm not saying zero for that, but what's been going on?
Feels low.
We're going to be watching the game. Fenway's just fucking rocking.
Yeah. The Purdue is just a pile of rubble, and Steve's like, my bad. My bad on the 5%, whole 5%.
There's a chance.
Thing.
I'm saying there's a chance. 1 out of 20.
The earthquake.
Listen, if you work in the city, stay away from tall buildings on Thursday, because this guy doesn't know what the fuck he's talking
about.
What
was the building you just referenced?
The Purdue?
Yeah, you said Purdue, I think.
You said Purdue.
He's got college basketball on the brain.
He does.
I get it.
Chicken
Jerry time. Buckets.
I didn't say Purdue.
We're you said Purdue, yeah.
The,
big time.
The most recorded line.
One of the clearest Purdues I've ever
heard. Check the tape. Check the tape.
Please do.
I said the Purdue. I was just in the building. I know.
That's what made it all the stranger. That's what
yeah. Yeah. If the Purdue building falls
I think you guys heard what you wanted to hear because you guys are fucking basketball chuckle fucks.
I've got Purdue on the brain. It's true.
Yeah.
A BBCF.
Shout out Italy. Wait, before you do it, can I just say one thing?
Go ahead.
Shout out to Bobby Delbeck for getting option today, by the way.
Really tragic. Man.
Cut his vine, I think. I think you're going to cut his vine.
Is that a show suspension?
Yeah, I feel like that's on me. I shouldn't have given him the chance.
No.
You know?
It wasn't going to be something good.
I didn't think he was going there, though. I didn't know.
That was low blow. That was unnecessary.
Do you think he intentionally did that before the suspension because that's worthy of a suspension in itself?
Yeah, he's a... Like,
it's actually kind of smart.
Like,
yeah, it's like when you get ejected and then you like shit all over the home plate in front of the umpire. Yeah, you're already ejected.
Yeah.
I'm getting my money's worth.
Yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
That's actually a smart move.
Yeah, he got his money.
It's news. We have to address it.
Not like that. We didn't.
No, we didn't. No.
It's been addressed.
Mm-hmm. I didn't say it rudely.
It was rude enough. All right. Maybe we'll be back on Thursday. Who knows? Who knows if my house is going to be standing on Thursday?
Beware of the quake.
Don't know. Don't know. Maybe emergency pod on Wednesday to take a look at the hourly. I just hate to leave people hanging like this. And I'm one of them. This affects me, too. I don't have tickets to the game on Thursday, but...
It affects all of us. We record after finales.
We record after finales, and we don't know if this game is going to be played. Because, I mean, either way, if it gets postponed, then we would have to do a pod about the two games played.
Yep.
There's a lot on the line here, Steve.
I know.
Your ass is in the jackpot on this one.
It's fair.
So... All right, I guess we'll be back on Thursday. I hope. I hope it's at a reasonable hour. 50-50 chance, I guess.
51 Fortnite.
All right. We'll see you then.
Buenas noches, amigos.